Cosmic constellation in the stars. That's me to sound. Can't catch me now. And by the time you see me, I won't be around. Houston, we up. Earth ain't enough. You can call me rocket girl. Oh, Major Tom, you ain't so tough. Those neon lights only in the road. My speed of light, I'll blow your mind. I'll be the feeling you'll be dreaming of tonight. Houston, are we up? Earth ain't enough. You can call me rocket girl. Oh, Major Tom, you ain't so tough. Watch me fly.
2018 GSL Season 2 Overgrowth.
GSL Codas. This is the last day of the round of 16. We're here in Group D. Another group of death. All the groups have been so good. GSL Codas champions here. World champions as well. More than one.
Dude, three GSL Codas runners up. Already you'd be like, wow, that's half a Sioux. That's pretty good.
Yeah.
And then three GSL champions. Wow, that's like an MVP. That's super sick. What about three world champions as well? Like, what? Do we have nine players in the group? No,
again,
only four.
This is our craziest GSL Codas that we've ever had. These players so accomplished. The games have been so good. If I had to pick the players who are going to survive, it will not be the Terrans, in my opinion.
Yeah.
I don't believe I'm even being very brave by saying that. I think that's
basically a coward.
That's the most basic prediction that you can give. Here's our results here from Group C, another fantastic day.
Yeah, that Group C was, I think, my favorite group of this round, really. Just fantastic. Classic and TY. Like, right now for me, and for my money tasteless, it's like Maru, Rogue, Classic, TY are a level above everybody else. Maybe Stats is up there. I don't know. We'll see. Maybe SOS. Maybe we'll see.
It'll be interesting if Classic ends up only facing Terrans as well. That's another thing to watch out for.
Jeez, you know what?
That's
actually, that is a true possibility. He has a possible all Terran run through the tournament now, which would be very Classic favorite at that point. But let's look at this group right now. Two Protoss, two Terran. Look at it. Oh my god, when the least accomplished player in your group is Gumiho, it's a pretty crazy group. And the second least accomplished is Stats. What?
Crazy, man.
2차 지명은 김대엽 선수에게 좀 넘어가게 됩니다.
딱 멤버들을 봤을 때 너무 다 잘해가지고 뽑을 사람이 없더라고요. 어떤 한 분이 적극적으로 오오. 저한테 뽑아달라고 어필을 해가지고
오오.
이게 아, 함정인가 아니면은 진짜 뽑아도 되는 건가
네.
싶어가지고 네, 변 선수.
변환우 선수, 변환 선수 마이크 한번 잡아주시고요.
진행된 슈퍼토너먼트에서 3대 0으로 좀 압도적으로 지기도 했고요.
네.
또 오늘 패치가 이루어졌잖아요.
네.
그게 프로토스전 패치인데 김대엽 선수 쪽 가면 아무래도 2주의 시간이 있다 보니까.
그렇다면 바로 D조로 들어가서 그리고 지명권이 가장 먼저 생기거든요. 그렇게 되면요.
그렇죠.
그리고 원하는 조를 그리겠다는 그 큰 그림. 자 그렇다면 변현우 선수 말고 김대엽 선수 조에 들어가서 두 번째 2차 지명의 지명권을 가장 먼저 손에 쥐겠다라고 생각 드는 선수 계세요? 없으면 김대엽 선수는 아마 변현우 선수를 뽑을 거거든요. 이신혁!
지명권이 있으니까 그래서 그냥 빨리 뽑히고 싶어가지고
어?
바로 지명할 수 있잖아요
있죠 네.
그래서 되게 좋은 것 같아요
그러면 완전히 여기서 프로토스로 깔아버리게요?
그러고 싶긴 한데
오!
근데 남아있는 프로토스 선수들이 다 네. 막강한 선수들이라
네.
옆에 있는 선수도 막강해요 원래
막강하고
사실 가장 강력한 선수라고 평가받고 있긴 한데 네.
최근에 테란
다 이겼어요
스타일상으로는 그래도 김대엽 선수가 가장 상대하기 편하고
와.
아 그러게요 저는 오. 먼저 뽑아달라고 이렇게 말씀을 오. 하시길래
오.
그래서 왜 이렇게 저한테 오. 고맙게 이렇게 오. 생각을 했었는데 이렇게 그 팀이랑 계획 속에서 이렇게
그러니까요.
준비돼 있었던 거였네요.
변현우 선수는 지금 원하는 그룹 D에 지금 들어가게 됐습니다. 변현우 선수는 큰 그림을 그 그릴 준비가 좀 돼 있거든요.
네, 프로토스 정했어요.
프로토스로?
네.
그 프로토스 중에서 여러 프로토스가 있는데 어떤 성향의 프로토스를 원하세요?
제가 생각하는 선수는 안정적인 선수가 아니에요.
아, 그러면은 마이크 김유진 선수에게 한번 넘겨보겠습니다.
아, 저도 뭐 괜찮죠.
어, 좋아요, 좋아요. 네.
그때 변현우 선수가 아니기 때문에
오,
할 만할 것 같아요.
이야, 저 변현우 선수.
근데 김유진 선수도 예, 그때 김유진 선수는 아니기 때문에
오!
말하는 걸 보게 되면 답은 정해져 있으니 대답만 하면 되거든요. 그래서 김유진이 손을 잡아
바로 데리고 와요. 김유진도 웃고 변현우도 웃어요.
이렇게 되면
예,
네, 디조 같은 경우에는 네, 복수의 복수의 복수조가 될 수가 있겠는데요.
지금 김대엽 선수는 얼굴이 썩었어요. 아니 지금 마이크 김대엽 선수 지금 변현우 선수 데려왔다가 큰 그림 그리려고 하다가 지금 여기다 프로토스 만나기 싫다고 했는데 프로토스가 오고 또 프로토스가 오게 생겼어요. 어떠세요?
네. 왜 이러시는지 모르겠네요.
자, 그러면 이제 뽑힌 김유진 선수의 소감 한번 들어봐야지. 원하는 대로 D조로 네, 들어왔습니다.
어, 근데 변현우 선수 못 만날 수도 있을 것 같아가지고
아~
해봐야 될 것 같아요.
네, 자 이렇게 해서 김유진 선수의 마지막 이야기를 좀 들어봤습니다. 자 이렇게 되면은 자 이신영 선수는 자동으로 그룹 뒤로 왔습니다. 자 김유진 선수가 가장 만나기 싫어했던 이신영 선수를 여기서 만나게 되네요.
제가 이신영을 진짜 싫어하거든요.
네, 네
그래서 얘는 진짜 꼭 보내줬으면 좋겠어서 이신영 좀 D조로 보내줬으면 좋겠어요.
누구랑 바꿀지까지 얘기를 해주면은 조금 더 좋겠죠?
고병재 선수 괜찮으면 고병재 선수.
와,
저도 정말 D조는 가기 싫어요. 정말 진짜.
예.
어차피 연습은 팀원들이랑 해야 되니까 유진이 좀 신경 써줬으면 좋겠어요.
와. 자 그럼 마지막 기회 좀 이야기하실 분 안 계시면은 바로 지명권 행사 들어가겠습니다.
오! 오! 오!
오! 아 바로
아 네, 진짜 이렇게 될 줄은 진짜 상상도 못했는데 제가 저 보면서 D조가 최악이라고 생각을 했거든요.
와!
근데 그 자리에 제가 앉아 있을 줄은 정말 상상도 못했어요.
So we've got two of the strongest ProDOS players in the world, also two quite recently accomplished Terran players.
Yeah,
it was not long ago that Beyond shocked the world and won with some of the greatest mic we've ever seen.
Mm-hmm.
Gumiho, not long ago a GSL Codex champion. The thing about SOS is he's been so consistent for so long and had so many insane games.
Yeah.
I just can't imagine him not advancing. That being said, GSL is really not his strongest tournament.
Yeah.
And then you take a look at Stats, and I mean, I don't know who's really playing better than Stats. Stats is really on on another level. It seems very much so like he's solved ProDOS overall.
Yeah, he's the most solid ProDOS and maybe player in the entire world at the moment. And for me, I look at Stats almost like I looked at Rogue in the other group, where I'm like, well, he's just getting out no matter what. There's only one scenario that Stats can get eliminated, and that's SOS winning the group and then Gumiho somehow getting him with death pushes. And I can't see it happening, truly, but it's like the only way that this guy would not advance, in my opinion. But for this first match, the fact that Byun wanted to be picked, okay, he thinks that the patch will help him. Okay, well, I mean, the patch technically does make his units better against ProDOS, so that's good. Okay, I can agree with that.
He might be able to pull some tricks off for sure.
But the fact that he says that Stats is the easiest ProDOS to play against shows me that he doesn't have a lot of self-awareness about his own play style.
I'm going to object you for a second, because I think what he means by that is because Stats is more passive and tries to go into a long game, it's going to allow Byun to try to push a lot. I mean, for instance, I don't think Stats is going to try to proxy anything crazy and all in. I don't think he has to.
Not as often, yeah.
But I think Byun wants to be able to play with his units and try to maximize the damage. That's what I think Byun was trying to say.
But this doesn't change my point where I think that, you know, he's lacking self-awareness as to his style. He's the most aggressive Terran out there. And I've been saying for years that Stats' style is a direct counter to Bjorn's. Stats always smashes Bjorn.
You do have a point. Sometimes the best defensive players just don't die to these guys that push a lot.
Stats.
Yeah, the absolute brick wall of Protoss. They call him the Shield of Ire. Greatest defensive player really ever at this point.
Yeah, I'd say better than Rain, to be honest. Yeah.
For a long time, we called him the spiritual successor to Rain. And but he seems to be an upgrade at this point, whereas Bjorn, on the other hand, he's an upgrade to MKP, truly. Just to melt some brains out there. They are such similar players, both very emotional, very micro-based. When they lose, a lot of times it's very strategic, where it's like, why did you keep dropping? You know, that type of thing. Of course, they used to be teammates and everything. He called himself Ghost King Prime at some point.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, there's definitely a lot of similarities there. And look at this, the proxy barracks.
Yeah, that's what I was waiting to really highlight here, that barracks put right out there. Now, let's see, with Stats coming in here, now he will know, okay.
No Nexus will go down, I think.
Something's gone awry here.
Goes right back up his own ramp. Going to throw down that Cybernex core, make a Zealot immediately. Stats knows how to stop basically every cheese. He is, again, the strongest defensive player, and he's doing everything correctly here. You got to get that Zealot out so that the Reaper can't just completely destroy your probe line.
Yeah. You know, it's so funny because I think you're very much right when before the game started that, you know, Rogue and Stats, there's a lot of overlap there. There's no clear way to beat him. They're just very good at defending. Yeah. They get to a longer part of the game. They get the right number of units. They know how to use it. They never overextend. How are you supposed to beat these kind of players? I mean, it's really quite tough.
Yeah, it definitely has to do with having a very strong strategic understanding of what you're doing, a great unit composition, that type of thing. Bjorn, of course, showing off great micro here with his Reaper so far. He had already got two probes. That was fast to get two probes.
Well, this is that.
Wow.
Bjorn, nobody is as good with the Reaper as Bjorn. That is actually a fact.
Yeah. Oh, you're certainly right about that.
Out of all the players in all of StarCraft and all the units in the game, Bjorn, Reaper goes together the best.
Yes.
So, not a shocker that he's doing that and making it work. By the way, he does have a Cyclone coming out as a follow-up here, so we might even see more aggression. Mm-hmm.
Well, the Cyclone is generally something you're just going to grab here, whether you're going to attack with it or defend with it. It kind of holds on against everything. The Barracks flying home right now. And of course, a Robo being made from Stats, the most defensive thing he can possibly make. Oh, that was kind of interesting. Bjorn started a second Cyclone when the probe got out of vision. I don't know if this was like a plan or something, but he canceled and went Reactor.
Yeah, I think he wants to keep Stats on the defense, make him squeeze out more units when he's in fact not going to expand at all. He's going to get that command center up, and he's going to try to stay back.
Yeah, and we'll see what his follow-up plan is here. And of course, with Stats, what is his? Does he chrono out? Yeah, immediate Immortal here, so. Definitely it's working somewhat.
Yeah, well, this is keeping Stats in the dark. He's ready for a possible attack to come up here.
Yeah.
He's still waiting. And, what the Immortal does, obviously it's still a great unit, but what it's also doing is it's not an observer. Mm-hmm. And so Protoss is really still in the dark for now.
Yeah, and when you're doing things like making an Immortal, that is going to make the double command center play much stronger for Bjorn, right? Because this is not an attacking build that Stats is doing. You could, in theory, make a Warp Prism and try to get something done. But in this type of game that we've seen so far with the proxy play, you kind of faked with that Immortal, right? Or the second Cyclone. So Stats is just playing pretty safe. I don't expect him to try to get aggressive in you. Even if he did, I don't think it would do anything. So strategically, to kind of double underline this, so far, Bjorn has done fantastically.
Yeah, I mean, so far, so good. The problem is, the longer the game goes on, how is Bjorn going to outmaneuver Stats? This is the problem when facing off against Stats. Stats navigates a really clean game. You know, it's hard to throw him off course. I think, though, Bjorn absolutely has dictated what's coming out here. Let's see if he actually gets a scan. Okay, that is so sick.
Yeah.
That was so good. You have to keep in mind that, at least for now, Sets doesn't have any easy way to try to come in here and check what Terran's doing. And I think,
yeah,
at least in the early part, the first 5 minutes from A to Z in that regard, I think that Bjorn has brought a really impressive game.
Yeah, this is the best opener I've seen from him in a Terran versus Protoss in a very long time. Like, he's really dictated the way that Stats is looking this game. And I was talking to you before that I was like, I just hope that Bjorn brings some quality TVP today, because what we've seen out of him in TVP lately hasn't been so strong. But this is really great. I love what we're seeing.
Well, let's also keep in mind that this is coming off the back of a pretty disappointing showing in the last tournament that he was in,
yeah,
where he was flushed out pretty quickly. And here comes the initial attacker. Let's see how this mine connects. Ooh. It bumps them back, not forward. Second Immortal out, and that means Bjorn's going to have to turn around.
Yeah, the Immortal is waiting in the main base because, again, Stats has no idea what's actually going on as his Observer got sniped. Look at how many Cyclones there are. That's very interesting that he's made this many Cyclones.
If you had covered the names up and asked me which game this was in this group, I would have thought it was Gumihel.
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, the Reaper was so good, maybe it would make you think twice, but totally. It seems more of a Gumiho-esque type of way to play.
Okay, so just now, at the 6-minute, 20-second marker, the Observer finally gets inside the main,
yeah,
only to be shot down again.
Sees that finish third command. You know, he sees that it is bioplay despite the amount of Cyclones that are out. But the way that Stats is playing is almost completely foolproof. Like, if you play this very well, two base Colossus, you don't die to anything. And he's not going to die to anything right now. Now, will Bjorn land that third command center and play a macro game from here? I want to see him aggressively take his base and keep his upgrades going and do all that. Because if he gets too aggressive against this super defensive play of Stats, he plays into what he made Stats do.
Yeah, that's a very good point. But Stats, the fact that he's been playing a blind man's game is really impressive.
Hmm. Well, this really shows you a lot about Stats.
This is part of
the reason why he's so good.
He's
and
a
he
blind
gets far
sword
everywhere.
Fighter in Ninja Scroll.
Yeah, he just
remember
he knows
that guy?
What you're going to do.
Yeah.
He has sonar like a dolphin.
Yeah, exactly. So we have a drop coming in here, and this should dislodge, really, some of the army here for Stats. Stats has Stalkers here, but I don't think that's enough of a deterrent. Oh, hold on. I'm sorry. He's actually unloading. He's not dropping in here right now.
Yeah, he might be going for getting some of these buildings on the fringe.
This is smart, especially if he gets a cybernetic score. That's just very annoying for Protoss.
Yeah, it definitely is a bit annoying there. I'm going to remake that.
Okay, now the Colossites come forward. I think that was a wise decision for Bjorn to pick up.
Ooh.
Oh, hold on a second.
He needs those force fields. Oh, and he kind of gets him down, does miss some of those force fields there, and loses one of the Colossus.
Oh, I don't know about that exchange. I mean, losing the Colossus is never a good thing, but I think Bjorn lost a decent amount of his army.
Yeah, I think that overall right there that we saw maybe just slightly better for Bjorn, but it was pretty close, I think.
It's very Bjorn-esque in that he sees it and he goes for it.
Yeah.
You know, Bjorn is a very much a player who reacts on instincts on the fly.
Yeah.
And you know, he's like a Rottweiler. Like, he will go at you if he sees your army.
Yeah,
and, you know, that's not something he wasn't planning on getting a Colossus. He sees that. He says, okay, I think if I do this just right, I think my micro might be stronger. He's going to go for it.
Oh,
now, here comes another attack. He's going to try to hit the Nexus here. Now, this is going to draw the army away, and he could be flanked here by these Marauders.
Okay, well, there's actually a Prism here. So Hot picks up this Colossus and will continue to do so. Really fantastic micro out of
Stats. Oh, my God. That was so good.
Stats. Yeah, Bjorn.
Okay. Now, this is where Bjorn is starting to start getting diminishing returns. He's trying to come in, I think, with really well-orchestrated attacks, but that Warp Prism juggling the Colossus, I'd ultimately say that attack was a failure there by Bjorn. Now, he's still macroing up. He's still got a very sizable army. But what Stats is doing is assembling a more complex unit base that's going to just do a lot more damage overall in the long run.
Mm.
I mean, especially when Psystorm comes out. That's going to be really problematic for any engagement that Bjorn is trying to pull off.
Yeah, that's it's super important that he gets up there as well. Both of their upgrades are at about the same time. Bjorn really getting his 2-2 quickly here. And Bjorn is making Vikings and getting a Ghost Academy. So he's really filling in his tech tree as well. We haven't seen any Liberators, but that's fine. You know, you can play this kind of alternate style. This is an older style of TVP for not having Liberators at this point, but, you know, that's fine.
Okay.
Oh my
this is
God,
a great
that's
snipe
a
here.
Sick pickoff.
Yeah. you know, I got to say, Giannis always got the right timings here. Like, he knows exactly when the Observer's going to be out. He knows exactly when the Colossi is going to be out. But, again, I think he pushed in maybe a little bit too hard. Let's see, though. The Cyclones are coming up. He is putting a decent amount of pressure on those Colossi that had to be picked up by the Warp Prism. You know, the problem is it in StarCraft and in most things in general, there's a defender's advantage.
Yeah.
Unless you're doing a very specific timing where you're hoping to get in there before some upgrade or some unit.
Mm-hmm.
We see Bjorn clashing in there. Now, the fact that he's keeping the Colossus count down low, if he wins this game, we could probably chalk up a lot of this to that.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I definitely agree with that, but here's the inconsistency for me. He was making Vikings four at a time, but he keeps sacrificing Marine Marauder to kill Colossus. Right. Generally, what you're going to want to do in this situation is you wait for your critical mass of Vikings, you kill the Colossus with that, then your Marine Marauder can clean up. Instead, we have this weird situation where if Stats stops making Colossus, he's actually going to be ahead because it's going to be like nine Vikings killing one Colossus, right? And then he's just got a stronger ground army because he's killed off a lot of Marine Marauder.
Yeah, you make a good point. I mean, he's building up a certain unit composition that's going to counter the Colossus anyway, so why hemorrhage that?
Yeah.
That group of infantry, right? That doesn't make any sense.
Well, the thing is, he's being very decisive with his play. He's seeing places where Stats has holes, and he's jumping upon them. It's just like, imagine right now if he had been making Liberators, not Vikings, and he's picked off two, three Colossus. What a different world that we're in at this point. Like,
sure.
I would look at this game and just say, oh, yeah, Bjorn has got this one sealed. But I look at the actual army sizes and the fact that I only see one Colossus. Okay, I guess he's starting another one, but if he gets a good eye on the amount of Vikings, he might stop.
Okay, a scan here, another big warp in. Liberation zones have gone down. Oh, Warp Prism was gunned down.
Oh, yeah, that's a
I think
really
that Bjorn's going to sink his teeth in now.
Yeah.
Okay, Colossus goes down. And I think Bjorn may. Okay, he's just going to regroup. Probably did a macro around there. And let's see if he tries to push it any further. I mean, the army that Bjorn has, especially with his kind of micro, this is pretty scary. Great EMP there, hitting that.
Ooh!
Whoa!
That flank
That's
of
so
storms.
Funny. That looked like it came from another game until our camera went up and we saw it. Was
Where
just
were
above
those?
The, I was like, I don't see Templars in there.
Crazy.
That was really good. And, you know, he doesn't have a ton of medevacs in here, so you don't know how much more energy if you're going to keep healing up his entire army after storms like that. Oh, the Sarkon! Okay, he gets it.
Well, still Stats trying to fight. Now some Liberators joining the fray. Still a strong army here from Bjorn.
Great play here by Stats, getting these Zealots over to interrupt the mining. It has to be noted, Bjorn has outgrown Stats army-wise.
Oh, yeah.
There's a chance if the push continues on, it may smother Stats.
Yeah, Bjorn has truly dictated this game from start to finish. Not saying that the game is 100% over, but it's looking very rough right now. A nice size storm goes down. He's going to need a few more of those, though. It looks like this base quite likely to fall.
Okay, Nexus taking a lot of damage here, and it will go down. And that is going to put Bjorn on four bases to the three here of Stats. And in fact, you know, Stats' army is getting whittled down here as well.
His Stalker is still doing, like, kind of okay. In come the rest of the Liberators. I think it might be GG time here for Stats,
though. The Stalkers are almost trapped at this point in time. They're running back. And Bjorn with really impressive play. It looks like he should be taking game one.
Yeah.
He can scoop up those Liberators and just push in again. There it is. All right, Bjorn with a 1-0 lead. Very impressive.
Certainly impressive.
And by the way, some of the best play I've seen from him in a long time.
I really like his TVZ lately.
Yeah.
But his TVP, like in Super Tournament, it was just like, what are you doing? In this game, though, he truly dictated the entire pace of the match. He proxies the double Reaper, right? And then he goes Cyclone. He shows a second Cyclone and cancels after getting rid of the probe. He goes into three command. He scans and kills the Observer as it comes in, right? Like, these were all fantastic moves. He's, like, forcing all these Immortals out of Stats. Immortals are great, but you don't want to make them early. He never got the scout down. His base was late. The moves to pick off Colossus were decisive. The fact he was making Vikings at the same time, I'm like, I don't know about that. But
Byun got himself a lead. He kept himself a lead. He forced Stats into all sorts of weird positions.
Stats does not look that comfortable right now.
Well,
you know, that's a pretty shaking loss there. That's not how Stats normally loses. So let's see what happens here on Catalyst. Again, this is a map where Stats can hug his side of the map and try to play the defensive game. But Byun, from start to finish, had some really solid play. Let's see if he can do it again.
Flex Stats.
You know, he was playing like a very solid brand of Protoss there, but strategically, Byun had a great plan.
Byun.
You know, in that last game, we got to go from the very beginning because I think that's really where Byun was able to leverage his position. He got in there, he killed two probes, which is pretty impressive to pull off in pretty much any, you know, pro game. Usually the defense is a little bit more solid there, especially for somebody like Stats. He then he fakes out the Cyclone. He forces an Immortal to be made, right? Because it appeared that Byun was going to rush right away.
Yeah.
Instead, he was putting a little bit more pressure on and expanding. And then he shot down the first Observer. I mean, how Stats is getting no intel. He's completely in the dark.
And that's, like, if you can force that out of Stats, he has to continue to play defensively. He goes into Colossus play. It's like his position was certainly playable, but he really didn't have the intel. He couldn't have active units because Byun was really controlling the map the entire game. And, you know, when you're forced into doing things like having Immortals early, guess what that stops you from doing? Going for Stargate with an Oracle, which would be an active unit that allows you to see what's going on. It stops you from getting your Observers out more quickly to see what's going on. It stops you from having Blink Stalkers to be out on the map pressuring. It stops you from having a Warp Prism over there trying to harass with some Adepts. It stops you from even making Adepts because they suck so badly against Cyclones.
In a lot of the highest level games, dictating what the Robo's making, like forcing the Robo to make certain things and then countering that, is one of the best ways to beat a Protoss.
It certainly can be, especially, I mean, we saw it there, right?
Thanks for coming down, guys. Hope you're enjoying the show. Yeah, when you saw that, you know, firing down the Colossus, you know, that of course forces you to either, you know, supplement that with more Colossus or something else. It was just a really smart way to handle the game.
Yeah.
And you know what? Maybe Byun's improved even more than we might see a lot more of this from him in the future. Maybe he's really hit the next level because I was really on the same page as you, Artosis, earlier on, where I'm kind of used to just seeing him be really good with controlling stuff and just winning fights, and it's impressive. But a lot of times someone who's super deep like SOS or Stats just, you know, plays around that and is fine.
Yeah. Some good micro there from the Reaper still, but look, man, I want to see Byun, like, return to his previous form and not just be a micro god, but also really show a deep understanding of what he's doing, you know, to kind of bring out the right builds on the right maps and the right situations. And it's been a while since we've seen that in this matchup, but that first game definitely gives us a lot of hope. Now, taking a look at what
this could be really
seeing
funny.
Here.
Okay. I was wondering if that would just finish on top of the mine. I'm like, that would probably be, maybe the easiest way to lose that unit. Have a bad start.
Indeed. Well, it looks like he's going to trigger the mine.
Oh, ooh, my God, he's so sick.
So quick.
That was cool.
Yeah, and look at this. Goes out and repairs it. Oh, or thought of doing it, at least. There you go.
I feel like we should give Stats a win just for being this good at timing this out. This is so cool. Let's not even talk while he does it. Is he going to do it again?
But
can we resume from replay, like go back and just... That was really cool.
Double Widowmine pickup here. Going to go up for a drop. Of course, Blink has been on the way. Notice the very different attitude of Stats in this game, right? There was no proxy. There wasn't an early Cyclone for him to scout with a second one faked. So, you know, he's getting his Blink and taking a quick third. He's taking all these liberties that you want to take as a Protoss to be able to get ahead.
Okay, here comes Byun now with those Widow Mines. Double Forge going down here as well. That's definitely at least for us watching, telegraphing that Stats wants to go for a long game.
Yeah, very.
He's much more interested in deflecting and blockading whatever Bjorn's doing, and saying that I am way stronger in the late game than you. Now, you know, Bjorn in the last game, he really just kept putting on so much pressure that Stats never really got to where he wanted to be, and you know, the game fell apart.
Yeah.
Playing to his own strengths, and I mean, if you know, if he did it one game against Stats, of all people, really, to do that against Stats, that's crazy impressive.
Yeah, that's a scary thing if Bjorn can do that against Stats, because this guy is normally the hard counter to Bjorn, who just wants to be aggressive, wants to keep going in, dropping, putting on that pressure. Normally, Stats can deflect it all so easily, but Stats has a very much better start this game, right? He's got his two forages, he's got his three bases. This is the type of game that Protoss players generally like to play. With this quick a blink and everything, it's going to be hard to get damage done. Bjorn is being very patient, though, with that medevac. He's making himself a good-sized army, but we don't see a third Nexus. So he's going to have to get some damage done coming up.
Right.
You can't just make a third command center right here and be okay.
I just want to point out, again, this feature of Bjorn so far here today. I know we're only in game two of today, but it keeps happening. He just always gets the Observer. Every time,
yeah, very good
every now. Time that comes in there.
Who's the guy that was getting every Observer?
It was TY who was doing it.
That was like hilarious.
He would walk out in the middle of the map. It's like he had the build so mapped out. He's either looking at the clock and just doing perfectly when they come out, but he would walk out into the middle of the map and scan and shoot the Observer and then walk back and then.
I remember Tasia being like that as well. Where
yeah,
just
he was
like,
another
no,
one.
Every Observer's done. Get out of here.
Yeah. Okay, so Bjorn's moving out now.
Yeah, and so he's got two medevacs on the map right now. He's got this one full of Marines, and he's got the one between the natural and third base.
Watch
with two Widow Hinds.
Then he shoots that Observer and just goes back home, and I'm like, okay, what's going on, man?
That would be funny.
Yeah.
But this is where Bjorn, we can see what he can really get done here. This is a pretty classic Terran type of move.
Now, Blink's available here, but this is a lot of Widow Mines.
Oh,
a decent number of Marauders. Okay, hold up. He's going to drop it over there.
Oh, my God.
Widowmines are going to hold this position, but the drops are what we really need to watch
for. Oh, so fast from Stats. Look at that. Bjorn just picks it back up. A drop in the
gosh.
Main. Stats is being
if only
really
there was
quick.
A term for this kind of pylon.
Okay,
so he's going to go ahead and take that down.
Right, he's actually going to engage the main chunk of army here as well.
Okay, not bad by Stats, but Bjorn is continuing to really make some serious blows here. I believe those Marines are actually still in the main. Oh, wow, and the mines get additional hits here.
Oh, God, yeah, 10 probes have fallen.
And he unpowered the gates. Okay, you know, there's a possibility that Bjorn just goes rinse and repeat, and it can actually...
Yeah.
He might be able to KO Stats.
He's killed off so many important units so far. Like, Stats is not really ready for this. Look at that. He's going to lose his Immortals.
God.
He might just lose O2.
Yeah, he might just lose right now.
This is so sad.
Second Immortal's gone. That's never a good thing.
Like,
okay, he's got one more in the group, but.
I tell you, based on Bjorn's play as of late, I really thought today, I'm like, well, Stats is just gonna monster punch him and just send him to the moon, but.
I like that you use the technical term monster punch him.
It's like a punch, but you got to imagine it coming from a monster, right?
You know, this is, man, you're paid to be here, bro.
Yeah.
You're just a real pro.
So monster punch him all the way to the moon, dude. But look, so far, it's been completely opposite of that, right?
I'm sorry.
Only one.
I'm sorry you said it. I'm like, that is just... All right.
Bjorn is playing really awesome, though. Like, his multitasking is super on point. He's whittled down a lot of the valuable units. Now, that doesn't mean Stats is out. This isn't a Colossus-based comp where literally you have to have your Colossus.
Yeah.
Instead, he's already gotten into 2-2. He has charge. He has blink. So you can remake this army once you lose it. Ooh, great.
Whoa!
Targeting, too. Wow.
Damn.
Wow.
Okay. Good decision-making. Instantly pulls
good
away.
Scan.
Stats is scrambling back. You know, as another drop might come up somewhere else.
Just,
by the way, this is a little bit different than the Bjorn that we're used to seeing. I know he's really aggressive and he's microing, but I'm not used to seeing him do it this well with mines.
Yeah, no, he's doing fantastic with the mines. He's being very careful about the drops as well. He did a little scan there to check if that's where the army was. It was. He turns around, regroups. He's, like, really forcing Bjorn, Stats to be way spread out. And it's not like Stats has a ton of intel as to what's going on. He has a few observers, but he's lost a lot as well.
Oh my god, oh, I don't see anything here.
Yeah,
he can actually just get the Nexus. It looks like he decides instead to go in there and try to chip off one of those Immortals.
Wow, he actually gets a lot of the Widowmines dead before they go off, so that's good. Blinks forward, but that's going to be it. Like,
well, the Stalkers are not... I think he just won this game.
Yeah.
Or as Artos would say, Monster punched him all the way to the moon, man.
He did.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what it's looking like to me. I'm so impressed with Byun.
Yeah.
This is really exciting stuff.
Okay, so we've started today off with an upset. GG.
Okay.
Well, sick. Wow. Cool.
Byun has fixed so much of his play since the Super Tournament, where we saw Stats 3-0 him, and it was, like, comical. It was like, what? Like, how did Byun qualify for this event? But here, Byun just smashed the most steady, solid Protoss in the world.
Yeah.
Like, Stats is the most accomplished player, for the last couple
right
of years.
That's got to be a weird feeling that he's having right now.
Yeah, he chose Byun because he knows. He's like, well, last time I played you, it was so easy.
In Korea, outside Korea, everybody nods towards Stats. Byun is, I mean, he's not long ago, Byun was the world champion, but he has just reasserted himself hugely.
Yeah, and the thing is, he played really great TVZ in his previous round, so... sky's the limit right now for Byun.
We're going to a commercial when we come back. Our next best of three.
We'll be right back. 아프리카 TV에는 당신이 아는 것보다 다양한 인종이 살고 있죠. 말 많은 인종, 발 빠른 인종, 잘 먹는 인종, 영리한 인종, 친절한 인종까지. 모든 게 컨텐츠가 되고 누구나 주인공이 되는 세상. 알고 보면 멋진 세상.
Are you free? Africa TV.
2018 GSL Season 2 CODES Overgrown. Who's the victim now? Stand up and take a bow. A bow. Face right, face left, face everyone you disrespect.
Welcome back. We got SOS versus Gumiho coming up next. Beyond beating Stats is really exciting.
It is. It is.
And we're seeing Beyond play, I think, better than we've seen in a really long time.
Yeah.
I know he's a world champion. Not the most recent one, of course. But so it's kind of weird to say that. But I am blown away by how he was handling that. And Stats did not look bad at all. I mean, I saw Stats had the adept timing so perfect that he was drawing mind shots out and shitting away.
I mean... Yeah, it's a wild thing that we see, but I'm so happy that Beyond has come today in tip-top form. He looked good in the last group stage as well, so maybe Beyond is back. The Horsemen are back together, Tasteless, all of them looking strong.
Yeah.
Now, of course, SOS, this is another question. Does this guy go to the finals once again? He's been, you know, he's been kind of in such a weird spot in recent years where it's like he's normally the guy that barely didn't make it to BlizzCon, the tournament he always wins when he goes. Like,
yeah,
it's been kind of sad in that way, but I don't know.
And Gumiho, despite being a pretty recent GSL CODES champion of this tournament, I think is actually overshadowed in accomplishments by our other three players. But look, Gumiho, he might be able to get out of this group first still. We don't know.
Gumiho,
he's got his own brand of Terran.
Yeah.
And, you know, if you're someone trying to learn Terran, I'd say careful with trying to learn what Gumiho is doing, because it seems like he's the only guy that can make it work.
And you're very right. He is a kind of like a strategic mastermind.
Yeah.
He makes all his own stuff. But anyways, this is kind of wild that Darkness Sanctuary made it through. So, okay, we're going to see the first game there. I wonder what Gumiho will do here.
Yeah, I'm not sure. Well, our game's loaded up, so let's find out. SOS versus Gumiho.
Jin Air Green Wings, SOS.
We're hoping to see some quality SOS play. This PvP is so good, I almost hope he loses this match.
Psystorm Gaming, Gumiho.
Now, Gumiho, Darkness Sanctuary doesn't get through the vetoes very often at all. In fact, there was like a stat at one point at a 40 matches, it was vetoed 39 times. It's just like, it doesn't get through generally. It's a giant map, especially in this matchup. You have to play completely different as Terran because, like, if you Protoss can do anything they want, and by the time your Terran army gets across the map, they have as much as you and they hold. So we've seen, like, for instance, when Alive played here, it was one of the most brutal things because Alive is like, I'll just play it like a map that I normally play. And it's like, no, you can't do that.
Thanks for coming down, everybody. Hope you're enjoying the games.
Lots different of people angle now.
It's too hot to be outside, by the way. When did it suddenly become planet Araxis or whatever? It's so hot. It is so hot outside.
It is definitely hot outside.
It went from too cold in Seoul to everything is wet and rainy to now it's too hot.
Yeah.
And that's why we have the best gamers in the world here.
Mm-hmm. Part of it for sure. Do you think there's any chance, Tasteless, Gumiho will do something like mech this game?
I don't
feel
see
like
why
if
not.
There's a map where Gumiho might be able to get mech to work out, it could be this one. Just because it's like
it's so far, but look at this proxy that we're seeing. This is so funny.
Yeah,
it's right in the middle.
It's right there by the tower, too.
Yeah.
Well, the funny thing about putting stuff out there like this.
Oh,
we love it,
you.
Too. By the way, you know, there's something funny about putting this proxy kind of out in the middle, like just right where the tower is, because that's, I guess you call it hiding in plain sight.
Yeah. Well, the map is so long that I think he just assumes nothing's going to go to the middle of the map for
a
while.
Yeah, yeah. No, exactly.
And he's right. Like, especially considering he's now killed that SCV.
It's funny, too, because with watchtowers on this map, that's not a particularly valuable watchtower as some other watchtowers are.
No, yeah.
It's not something you're like, oh, well, if I get this, I might see. Because, you know, it's such a big map that people can go around it. So this is why SOS is won the World Championship twice, is he plays so... He knows how to outsmart smart people, and those are the scariest kind of people to play strategically in StarCraft.
Yeah.
They understand how other smart people think, and they go, oh, okay, well, I see that you're intelligent, so you're going to discount all these things. So what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to do something that almost doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
And these are the people, of course, that smart people are the most upset with, too, when they lose on the ladder, right?
Yeah.
Because they're busy. They're typing out all this awful stuff about how they're, you know, they actually understand the game and you don't. You don't realize it's actually SOS on the other side of the keyboard staring blankly waiting for you to leave the game.
Look at this. Hiding his Hellions. I think he only saw one there. Cyclone's coming out. Oh, my God. The Oracle's just going to fly right in, Tasis. Look at this. Sees the third command center and is going to get plenty of damage done because these Oracles aren't done yet.
I want to take a look at Gumiho's face. He's like, oh, my God, that's in the middle of the map. All right, so the Hellions go by. This is actually quite bad. The Hellions are still – it's going to be a long time before the Hellions can get up there. They're only just now going to get to this base. So that was the most damage that SOS could have done there. I was wondering about this. I said with four of them, he might be able to run up the ramp. Okay, they need to attack or do something.
Wow.
Okay, I think Gumiho's freaked out.
This is heartbreaking for Gumiho. He could have done so much more damage. The damage isn't done, but trust me, he could have done so much more damage than whatever the hell he's getting done.
Oh, my God. Okay, actually, if he strafes right – does he actually get this?
He gets out, barely.
Oh, no!
Oh! Wow, I feel like...
I thought he was going to get out just barely. Yeah, I think he didn't quite angle that right.
Huh.
Does he make another Oracle?
I think you're right. There might have been a turn in there or something.
Do you keep making Oracles and just attack in here? Is that the plan?
Well, it's SOS, so
he makes
a third
base.
You can probably do both.
Yeah.
He's like, two Oracles flying in. Oh, God, that Widowmine. That would be insane if he catches one. The amount of damage he dealt. Wow.
Oh, my God. But the problem is, okay, hold on. Just taking a glimpse here. Okay, now there is a mine. I wonder if he's just outside of range, man. The problem is that that mine doesn't cover the expansion, but that's kind of why it's there, is there's a chance that, okay, hold on. He's going to push up here. Now, we don't really have much other than this bunker. I believe the SCVs repair this in time no matter what. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
But he made the Cyclones go down and flies in with the Oracles, gets a couple more kills. Seems like that was actually worthwhile to lose the Zealot.
He's hoping he can get up here just fast enough. And what's funny is, keep in mind, he's killing so many workers, so it might look like, well, that attack's not going to end the game. But the truth is that Gumiho has 27 SCVs.
Yeah, and killing any SCVs after you've killed as many as he opened up with the Oracles, it gets, like, stronger. And the thing is, like, he identified that there's only two Marines in the bunker. That takes a long time, two Marines to kill a Stalker. He doesn't care if he loses a Stalker until he gets four, five, six SCVs.
You know, some players can actually get way too intimidated at lower levels from bunkers because they take a while to kill. But, yeah, if there's only two Marines in there, do you really care? Are you scared of two Marines normally? No. Like, you could ignore it. Yeah. So now he's got four. But this is still a pretty robust army here for SOS.
Yeah. I think he's just about done with these moves, though. You know, with the two Cyclones sitting there as well. Maybe the Oracle can try to go back in, or the Oracles, rather. Setting up the double forge. He's got his three nexuses up. Of course, Gumiho has three command centers, but not even enough SCVs for two bases, considering he's been repairing so much and all this.
Okay, going to gun down that plate. Again, Gumiho's really been pushed into a corner here. And, you know, one of the key factors of this map, and we were talking about this before the game just turned into a brawl right away, but... this is a map where you're so far away from each other, it's kind of hard to get a closer. But it looks like what SOS is doing is he's keeping such a high amount of pressure on that he's going to outgrow Gumiho. And I'm not really sure what the plan is for Gumiho other than to just try to stabilize here. I mean, even doing these little things like coming forward and trying to hit that depot, he's keeping the pressure so high.
Yeah. He's keeping Gumiho sitting right there, afraid of all-ins and things like that. Gumiho doesn't know exactly what's going on. We haven't been hearing any scans. He's been dropping mules considering his economy's been hurt. So it's hard to say what SOS is doing at home.
Again, he just comes in here and blinks.
Oh, you're kidding me.
He's so good. Okay, so if you take out Stim, then they don't get to leave their base for an even longer amount of time.
I think I can count the amount of pro games on one hand where the Stim upgrade was killed in the Terran 1.
Yeah. It's just the most important upgrade, really, in order to give Terran the initiative on the map.
You know, I guess a funny thing about Darkness Sanctuary is you can't really hit when Stim finishes anyways because it's so long. I almost feel like never attacking is the only... This is like the Warren Buffett map. Like, you get your value in early and you just never spend it. You know what
yeah,
I mean? Like,
yeah.
you're sitting there, you're getting upgrades, and the right amount of time to sit in your base is forever.
Yeah.
Like, going across the map to attack is so difficult. It just seems like a map like that, in my opinion, in this matchup.
So, Gumiho is, I guess, going to try to come out here. Again, with no Stim, the Terran army, it's just not a real threat, you know? Mm. It's not just that they are going to attack faster with Stim, it's that they run faster. They can get closers and fights more quickly. Yeah. Terran units are basically just so awful without Stim, it's hard to emphasize.
Yeah, bio is just,
it
doesn't,
you know,
do anything.
Yeah.
And we have Protoss upgrades, so it's pretty important. Now, SOS is actually coming out. He might feel like because Stim is gone, he can get something done here. He has a lot of Zealots. Charge is about to finish. He does have 1-1. 1-1 and Stim still not done for Gumiho here. Oh, man. So Zealots in the main base with charge done. Gumiho has to bring a bunch of units, and now the big attack from SOS hits elsewhere.
He does not blink through. The problem is the sheer volume of units. Well, the Zealots are not in a great spot, but
yeah.
Those force fields are quite good. Is this actually the end?
Look at those SCVs.
Good
that SCV is a
stop.
Beautiful block. Oh, my God. Those Zealots, if those things had been attacking this whole time, this game would definitely be over. It might be anyways.
I think it might be over anyways. I think he's going to have another warping round, and there are still Zealots in the main attacking whatever SCVs are still there. SOS takes game one, GG. Look, really impressive game. And again, it's one of those weird-ass SOS openings.
Yeah.
Proxy, Stargate, right in the middle of the map.
Indeed. And Gumiho, the thing is, he ran over with four Hellions, and he was against two Stalkers and, like, a Zealot.
Yeah.
He did mess up there when he was trying to get up the ramp. He lost two right away. Well, he didn't shoot as much as he could. He actually could have killed as many probes, maybe, as SCVs were killed by the Oracles.
You know, the problem is that the Oracles were killing so many SCVs, he was trying to deal with that.
Yeah.
So,
well, he had so little defense at home that it almost felt like he should have just ignored the Oracle. It's like, well, you don't even have anything that hits air. Are you really going to run and, like, tax that? Maybe it would have been better to really focus on the Hellions. But regardless, SOS gets the better end of that. Could have gone sour early on, but finishes it well.
Nicely done. We're going to go into game number two. It's going to be on Eastwatch. It's loaded up. This is SOS versus Gumiho. Okay. All right, so Gumiho, proxy me. Teach you a lesson, SOS. Now, the question is, where will it be placed and will it be spotted?
Well, with the speed of this probe sent out, this is like if you scout after your pylon instead of after your gateway, you know so early that you can kind of just do like a one base build. Yeah, the double.
And one thing about an SOS is he doesn't just play a game of StarCraft. He plays a best of three, a best of five, a best of seven. He knows how to sequence his strategies. So he opens up with one thing. Okay, it's filled your mind with certain ideas and have shown you a certain type of play.
I feel like it's mildly interesting that there's no depot. He put his depot near his command center. Normally you build them at the front so you can wall off of the factory.
He's going to scout it.
Yeah. Peek-a-boo. Not going to be able to stop it from being finished.
Still.
It's too far along.
Wow, this is very disheartening here for Gumiho.
But you can't just play normal from here. Like, you can just, you know, we saw Byun make, like, two Reapers and a Cyclone and go Command Center.
No, you know, you're totally correct. I mean, it's not like the game's over by any measure. But, I mean, this is just a bad start. Now, that's funny.
Yeah.
And so he hides another building out here. He's doubling down, but that other building hasn't been scouted.
And
but, of course, the probe's in the main, so he sees the lack of that building.
Yeah, and even the, like I was talking about that depot there, as soon as you don't see a depot at the front of the wall, it kind of points towards something like this just because you want to have your wall up ASAP. Otherwise, something like an adept can come up and ruin your SCV count. So Proxy Factory should be an easy tell here, expecting SOS not to die. That doesn't mean that Gumiho has no chance here, though.
No, Gumiho can still make this work for sure.
By the way, look at the difference in Reaper Micro between Gumiho and
Byun,
because Byun with one against one Zealot. Normally, you make the Zealot because they have a hard time microing, right?
Yeah.
But here, it's like if Byun got two probes and Gumiho got zero. Definitely showing differences in their superpowers.
So Gumiho's going to pull away the barracks, unless he lands it somewhere else, but I think it's just headed back. And so the Zealot's going to scout that it's gone, but the threat is not. The threat is absolutely not. He is still making a Cyclone just outside here. You know, that probe was alive for a very long time.
Yeah.
It's very uncomfortable for Gumiho.
Got so much intel.
The thing that good StarCraft players like more than anything is vision of what their opponent's doing.
Yeah.
If you have vision, I mean, this is why when map hackers once ruled the land long ago in StarCraft 1, you know, it was so abusive because you just see what they're doing and you make the counter to it. Yeah. So definitely an uncomfortable opening here in a lot of different ways for Gumiho. Not a game he can't – I mean, he can absolutely win this still, but it's been bumpy.
Well, yeah, this is – he's going to be pretty heartbroken, I think, considering that it is one Stargate Phoenix with three gateways. That is – I can't think of a better way to counter what he's up against.
So SOS immediately and reflexively – has that Cyclone come back and chase that. Now, this is the moment he needs to do some damage. Moments like this, you want to check the pylons. Okay, what can he possibly unpower?
Look at this. Doesn't actually target on the medevac. I thought he might choose to do that rather quickly, but I mean, the Phoenixes can just wreck everything from here.
Yeah, and this is a really straightforward win. You think Gumiho's going to stay in the game, Artosis?
Yeah. Doesn't want to just go immediately. But this is like, oh man.
Get that back in the air.
Look at this. SOS not microing perfectly right now, but I don't think it's entirely needed.
So now you're going to see why Vikings aren't usually landed to fight. One of the worst ground units in the game. But he was trying to basically avoid those Phoenix shots.
Well.
Yeah, this has been a brutal series, I'll say that much.
Yeah, like every unit Gumiho's making is dying. Neither of them have expansions, so it makes sense for Gumiho to stay and try to make something happen. And he did kill some workers. But when you look at this Phoenix count, how many workers do you think these will eventually kill? Like,
even
if he has units, like I see he's made a bunker at home preemptively because he's like, oh, well, I can't just defend because the Phoenixes will kill
everything.
I'm actually
amazed that he's still making that Cyclone. I guess he wants to buy time, but... Yeah, I mean, Terran has been completely reset. Protoss has so many tools at his disposal, really. And there's an empty bunker with units attacking at the front. One of the sadder things to see.
Yeah. Oh,
in fact,
man.
I don't even know. Is that the right angle? Can they actually still repair that in time?
I don't think there's any way to live here. Look at this. Oh, my God. The Phoenixes, if they had energy, Gumiho would leave this game right now.
Watch this. He's going to go to the side.
But there's no way to really stop the never-ending pressure that is going to occur now.
I wonder how many units were actually picked up in this game. You don't see Phoenixes get... I mean, Phoenixes can get a lot of value, but this is pretty impressive. By the way, that factory has been landed inside the main here, and I hope to draw attention back here, but it seems like SOS...
Ooh!
The left hand knows
cool
what the right hand is doing here. Oh! Yep, yeah. That was handled perfectly.
Yep. Oh, boy.
Oh boy, indeed. Gold base being taken.
Look at these supply differences right now. Like, Gumiho just can't scrape anything together. Look at that. His Stargate, or his Starport rather, that walks somewhere else. Oops. Gets scouted immediately when he's trying to go into Cloaked Banshee. Just. Oh, man.
But it also seems like SOS knows all the forks that Gumiho can take.
Yeah.
And, you know, says, okay, well, you know, basically, I think Gumiho was really smart for trying this, but he hit a bunch of buildings. He kept trying to double down, triple down, quadruple down on hidden stuff in the hopes that SOS would get comfortable, but it just never worked. He stopped it every single time.
It's like SOS figured out what Gumiho was up to, and then he pushed him down a set of stairs made out of rakes, at the bottom of which was a wood chipper, and that's what we're watching right now.
I feel like this is Inception or something, like he went three layers deep in the dream and gave him the idea to do the proxies.
Well, he scouted, you know, right away after his pylon. When you do that and someone's proxying on a, like a two-player map, you get there and you're like, oh, you're proxying, and then you do a one base build that kind of counters everything. This is definitely a decent example of one. Sometimes you see people go robo, right? Like Stats is, I guess, more of a robo guy. I went for that against proxy, but you can definitely just sit there and go Phoenixes, no problem.
Look at the pressure. You know, he doesn't have to get that depot, but he's actually leaning that hard. I think it's virtually impossible for Gumiho to win this now.
I'm trying to imagine
a game where he gets down the ramp. All that needs to go wrong now is for the Stalkers to blink in the main, and then he gets stim again, and it just...
Well, if he can medevac down some units and has stim, like, his army heads up might be able to do something. But
stim is going to get done before blink does.
Yeah. But with the gold base up, like, SOS should be getting a bunch of gates, a bunch of units up.
Well, he has unloaded some of that army, but it's spotted. Now, he does get the Oracle. That's something. But, you know, again, this map is huge. So, I mean, to travel all the way across the map with the with SOS knowing, it's just the odds are so slim of anything working.
Ooh. Gumiho trying his best here to make something work. Walks in that stasis sword. That's all right, though. He's, you know, he's starting to get some sort of army together.
Okay, SOS is going to have to pull back for a second here. Yeah. Now, I think this is something SOS is perfectly fine with. How do you think that? Do you think that a Sentry is going to get away, Artosis?
No.
You think Stim's going to finish maybe him. Just get it?
Yeah. Stim and Marauder and go catch it.
You think there's going to be one force field that'll pop up if it has the energy? Yeah. You know, like right before a Sentry dies, I'll just spam out a force field, even though it's not an attack.
Certainly. I know that one well.
So as Gumiho is attempting to expand, by the way, if Gumiho wants to take a third base, he'll probably have to float his main out.
This is actually a decent chance for Gumiho. He's made a good army. He's bringing his SCVs.
Look at this. This is, I think this is his best shot. He takes all the SCVs. He doesn't want to end a long game. He's basically taking everything, the kitchen sink, and he's throwing it at SOS.
Blink is just about to finish here. This is so crucial that he has Blink. It gives him a chance still.
Now SOS needs to buy time. He blinks away, but the Zealots get mowed down. And he's going to try to isolate this army from getting back to the main. But of course, with Blink, he can absolutely get there.
Was SOS too greedy here? Is he going for a base trade? Oh, my God.
Oh, my God.
Oh, this is so funny. What? This non-attack move. I guess.
All right.
Well, that pylon. Oh, that pylon. That's brutal.
Buckle up, everybody. We have a base trade going on here.
Okay, so now, what's the base trade victory condition?
Hold up. There's a floating building right just above the gold base for Terran. Are you seeing this on the minimap? See that little red blip above the gold base? Is that the starport?
Oh, yeah, that is the starport. Yeah.
So, of course, the win conditions for situations like this is whoever destroys the last building for their opponent wins the game.
SOS has money and a
probe out of the map. What am I saying? Yeah.
But Gumiho's done this very well. Like, he immediately dropped some units down to kill that gold when he saw that this was going to be a base trade type of scenario. There's not enough money for another command center, but he still has one. This is wild. I guess he's going to go catch the command center. Where do you build a building with this probe? You have 700 minerals.
Well, you know, one thing to note is that the map is huge. So you probably want to spread your buildings out quite a bit.
Everything will be revealed soon, right? So does he make a nexus so everything doesn't get revealed?
if you do.
Yeah, I think you do. I think that's
you
what
don't
you
get to see where the Nexus is, but.
Yeah, you can only make one.
This is
so kind of
crazy. I'm surprised that this is how this game went down when SOS had such a demanding lead. I guess he got a little bit too greedy. Gumiho just nailed something sharp. But very few buildings left. Like, if Gumiho just gathers his units together and floats some buildings over him and walks across the map, can he break him?
Yeah, I think that's what he wants to do is a building push. You got to be careful, though.
I'm not sure if he can actually do it, though, with two sentries on top of the ramp and this many blank stalkers.
Where? Oh, I see the Phoenixes are actually not far from the Terran army.
And yeah, he should be dogging them a little bit, I think.
Yeah, he makes a Nexus down there in the main. But, you know, with Terran having this many... Oh, okay, no, wait a minute. This is such an odd game.
Because stalkers on top of the ramp and a couple of force fields, like, you're not going to get up there and kill the Nexus, right?
It seems like Terran shouldn't be able to drop easily, right? A drop is a real gamble. He has two sentries. I have to imagine they have a decent amount of energy, right?
With the Phoenixes there, you can't drop because the Stalkers can take on three medevacs of units, I would say.
But it's a long time before SOS is going to start mining again.
That's true.
And actually get an economy, like a real economy actually going here.
But Gumiho has to try something.
Okay, well,
where are those Phoenixes?
Where are the Phoenixes?
Oh, they're actually hunting a building. So he's putting a clock on him in that way?
I think that was a...
I think
this is unwise.
I don't think this works at all for Gumiho, but he's got to try it. He's got to try it.
Now, remember, these medevacs, they don't have endless energy. They have a lot, but there's not... Well, I guess he can use the SCVs to repair the medevacs.
Oh.
Okay, he baited that out. Nicely done.
I think that could have been slightly better. Like, if you do it and even one SCV gets stuck, right, that's more value.
This is all a numbers game.
And look at that. Oh, man, he's using that stalker range on the high ground. SOS just a master of these situations.
No one
is better at these situations than him.
Medivacs are totally full. And, you know, SOS can start mining again. Gumiho cannot. Gumiho has to end this. The first probe is mining.
Whoa! Yeah, that force field.
Hold on. There's a drop coming in over here.
Yeah, he's got to destroy the drop.
It
is so crucial. And if he gets the medivacs, that's huge as well. Utilizing the Guardian Shield here.
He should have one more. Force field if he wants.
Yeah, he needs the force field too. It's super. Oh my God, he actually just lost.
Oh
a extra
my
there.
God, is that tight?
Ooh.
Looks like you know the numbers are getting lower here.
Yeah,
I mean, there's no longer a sentry in this game.
Yeah.
So it's just the Terran muscle.
9 stalkers against 2 medevacs with a Marauder and 12 Marines.
He's got him cornered.
CVs.
Keep in mind, that's the last building right there. Is he going to try to just gun it down?
Yeah, but he can make some more buildings. If he right-clicks on that, the probe got out. Look at this.
Oh, my God.
This is crazy. Oh, he makes a geyser. That can be shot from the high ground.
I don't think there's enough stalkers here. But they might have – actually, the medevacs might have run out of energy.
Yeah, but there's only 3 stalkers.
GG, Gumiho did it.
Wow.
Craziest comeback.
That was insane.
Craziest comeback. Oh, my God. What a game.
I can't believe that happened.
You do not get better StarCraft than that.
No, that's like, it really, the early game went so heavily in SOS's favor, and then he just was like making a few too many nexuses, not enough gateways. Gumiho had enough where SOS decided a base trade was the best scenario.
I don't think that SOS should have made the third nexus. He had a gold base.
Yes, no, I think you're exactly right. That's where he went wrong. If he added 3 more gates instead of a nexus, right, and gone up to 8 gates instead of 5, and he's just sitting there making units, it almost doesn't even matter what the units are. It feels like he just kind of holds, especially if he's like recalls in his main base, force fields a ramp or something, but then Gumiho's on 2 base, right? So you got to be a little bit careful there. Gumiho will have reinforcements eventually. So, hey, look, it's a decisive move from SOS, and that is important.
All right, Gumiho did it. Can he do it one more time? SOS definitely full of regrets after that game. It's loaded up. We're going to Catalyst. The winner goes on to face off against Byun in our winner's match.
Dude, yes.
Do it. So in theory, you don't do the same thing over and over in StarCraft, right? Because a smart player makes adjustments and stops you. But Gumiho is trying to pull an SOS on SOS here. He is once again opening with a proxied barracks.
Yeah, he sure is.
But SOS is scouting right away as well.
Indeed. That very quick scout once again. And once again, the depot in the near the mineral line, right? So that points towards a proxy factory as well. And it's especially interesting that his buildings aren't in his main base this game for SOS.
Yeah.
They're out front. That could mean that SOS was pre-planning to do, like, the Zealot Stalker rush to cancel a command center here. That's somewhat popular recently. But yeah, now he's going to find this immediately. It will finish once again.
Watch this game go exactly as the last one. They base trade, and then
SOS
wins. And he's like, I had to make a point.
Yeah.
this best of three is a parable, okay?
Oh. We don't deserve him. He's too great. He's too great for us. Ooh. Oh, the factory is being hidden behind his mineral line this time. That's super clever. Because right now for SOS, this should look like there's a proxy factory somewhere, right? But he sees the SCV come back at the same time. Okay, he's going to see the fact. There it is.
I'm so glad that it's SOS in this situation against Gumiho. This is going to make it interesting. I feel like SOS is our build order yogi. We just want to be around SOS's builds all the time.
Yeah, that's very true.
They make us better people. They make life better.
Except, oh my God, that is. I really like that too. Like the flexibility that's in there, right?
That's right. Yeah,
it's definitely part of it.
He's really in one with the game, you know.
Yeah, and like last game, for most of it, he was all like, "Namaste in your base, bro."
Yeah, I mean. Hold on, man. This Reaper's trying to do a lot
of
damage. Four kills.
That is a serious amount of kills. Dude, I guess...
Get him!
The Terrans are just, like, fighting back so strongly,
Did
I
Bian
guess.
Did Bian push Gumiho out of his chair, and now he's playing this game? What's going on?
Seriously.
Yeah. It's Bian and Gumiho in Archon mode against SOS. I can't believe it.
They're tagging each other in
That's
at this
right.
point.
Yeah.
Six probe kills. That's so crazy. That's so many probe kills.
Well, our predictions might be way off today, Artosis.
Yeah, I thought the Protoss were just going to rocket right through the group.
We're going to lose our jobs to that octopus that predicted the World Cup. I mean, this is what's going down here.
Octopuses are smart, man.
There was one octopus, right? Do you know about this whole thing?
Yeah, I heard something about an octopus. Like,
it was just like picking flags, and it just kept getting it right. It's like, wow.
Well, to be fair, it's soccer. It's like the dumbest sport, right?
Yeah, so. it's by far the worst e-sport out there.
Well, that's a fact, man. I know that FIFA's always at like
They haven't patched that game in a long time. Yeah. There's too much redundancy in the maps in soccer.
I know, right?
Everybody outside America's
screaming And they always
football.
Use the same units.
The same units, yeah. Dude.
Oh, boy.
Surprise.
Yeah.
So a lot was hinged on trying to... You know, these guys are kind of crazy with games like this.
Yeah.
Like, who needs expansions,
well, this
okay?
This is a crazy match, there's no doubt. When
he
you think about these
all
two players
three
even.
Gates.
And look, he's going Cloak Banshee behind it against an SOS that's like just skipping detection. Oh boy.
Well, SOS has to do a lot very quickly here. You know,
and he was faking a shield battery and he canceled it. This is so funny. What am I even looking at? He was like making a shield battery. He's like, nah, get rid of that. Because the shield battery really didn't make too much sense unless he got attacked right away. That Cloaked Banshee, though, that's going to be brutal. Four Cyclones up the ramp. Yeah, try to break that. It's going to work out perfectly.
Well, Gumiho definitely has, I think, a cleaner ending here.
Dude, I think he's just going to win with this.
Yeah.
This Banshee's going to kill everything.
It will, and I don't believe there's any real way to get up the ramp.
If he doesn't blindly make, oh, God, this is really good for him. Okay, he scouts it. That was so important. Now he can get a shield battery and go Robo immediately. Shield battery really slows down Banshees.
Robo started.
Yeah.
Look, the Cyclone just ran over
that.
You
better be making a shield battery, I swear.
Blake started. Uh-oh. Okay. Banshee's coming. It's not there yet.
Where is it?
I think it's at the center left.
Okay.
See it flying up there.
Yeah.
This is just going to get up there,
Look
man.
At that attack.
This is a lot of Widow Mines, dude.
Wow, is Gumiho just going to slaughter in this game?
I think he's going to power bomb them.
Do you think?
I think he's going to suplex
this
him like
This is
going to
look more like a
Street
monster
Fighter.
Punch.
Oh my God, he instantly.
Yeah.
GG.
Wow. Well, okay, this
what
this,
a series.
Everything turned on its head today, okay? Like, stats has generally always killed Bjorn.
Guys, let's all just go get a tattoo now, all right? Let's just do it. Let's all get a tattoo and remember this.
Crazy.
Yeah, this best of three.
And if you look like Todd, just get a tattoo removed.
Yeah, get a tattoo. You're so funny. That was so impressive there.
Yeah.
Gumiho beats SOS in like that. Today's games have been so good.
Life They've been crazy.
Good.
They've been awesome. And
yeah.
It's like such a turnaround too. Like SOS was looking great in game one, and here we are in game three, and Gumiho has cleaned him up. We get a TVT now.
TVT for the winners. Bjorn versus Gumiho. Stick around.
be nice to hear you say, are you still with me now? In the darkness of the night, I can hardly see the light. Can you still see me now? Any other day, I would love to be okay, but times are changing now. So come and take my hand, babe, I'll make you understand that I'm still with you now, with you now.
아프리카 TV에는 당신이 아는 것보다 다양한 인종이 살고 있죠. 말 많은 인종, 발 빠른 인종, 잘 먹는 인종, 영리한 인종, 친절한 인종까지. 모든 게 컨텐츠가 되고 누구나 주인공이 되는 세상. 알고 보면 멋진 세상.
Are you free? Africa TV.
2018 GSL Season 2 CODES Overgrown.
Cause you give me just a little, but I'm gonna need some more. Don't you treat me like a stranger, I've been close to you before. Got me feeling like a rebel, breaking none of my own rules. Oh, I know that no one got nothing on you. No.
nothing on you, you, you got nothing on you, you.
Time for Bjorn versus Gumiho, the match I did not think we would have in the winner's match.
Literally the opposite of what I thought was going to happen.
Yeah, this is wild.
You know,
Bjorn and Gumiho, I'm not sure really what to expect here. Both these guys are great with their engagements and their control. They both have very different approaches.
Yeah.
To the game overall. Bjorn, you know, most emphasis on aggression and just solid control, microing, especially with small groups of units. Gumiho definitely has his own route with techs and build orders.
Yeah.
But that last game we saw back there from Gumiho really makes me second guess the way I'm looking at, honestly, both of these guys. They played so well today.
They did.
So exciting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's so nice to have Bjorn back in good form. We haven't seen too much TBT lately, though. It just hasn't been a matchup that's popping up. I have definitely heard some musings about how the matchup has changed quite a bit. There's a lot of different strategies that can be used. A little bit of rock, paper, scissoring going on and stuff. But I'm excited to see these two clash, especially because Bjorn is generally a bio player and Gumiho oftentimes is a mech type of guy.
Yeah,
so
he likes the Cyclones a lot of times.
Yeah, we might be able to see that clash of styles, which
Man
is always fun.
Man versus machine, Artosis.
Yes.
I'm ready. We're going to go on our new map, Lost and Found.
PsyStorm Gaming, Gumiho.
Yeah, I'm really wondering what these guys will actually pull out against each other, but this has been such an interesting day so far. And in fact, at GSL, right, we had the best round of 32 we've ever had. In this round of 16, we're seeing people buck trends, right?
Yeah.
Deer, who looked the sloppiest so far, won his group. We've seen, for instance, Classic got picked by Dark. Why did he get picked by Dark? Because Dark always eliminates Classic. He felt like he would be able to beat him, right? 2-0. Classic 2-0's Dark. Stats, he got the second pick, right? Who'd he pick? He picked Bjorn because he always beats Bjorn. He wrecked him in Super Tournament. And just generally speaking, his style normally destroys the way that Bjorn likes to play TVP. And then Bjorn 2-0's stats. And we're just sitting here now, and it's like, wow. Wow, this is – it's crazy to see how these players turn and revolutionize themselves and bring their level up to deliver it on a day like this.
This season of GSL is by far the best episode of Game of Thrones I've ever seen, Artosis.
Yeah, it's pretty darn good.
You know, coming into this, I expected, of course, to see awesome play from both Bjorn and Gumiho, right? But they've really expanded the way that we're looking at them. I mean, in a lot of ways, Bjorn had that same micro, yet he had the kind of control that you see from TY. And when you look at Gumiho, the fact that he normally opens up, he likes to push, he likes to be aggressive, he likes to drop, and he's got a kind of unusual tech pattern. But the way he handled a crazy all-in situation in a base trade against SOS, we don't see that kind of stuff. Mm. I mean, everybody is delivering here.
Yeah, yeah.
And we're seeing a real shift of the guard here with who's coming out as the better player.
It's super cool. And this, what this match here means, being in the winner match, is that we have another Terran moving forward. And that's just, it's like, wow. Awesome. Because it was kind of feeling to me like we were just going to get two more Protoss up there. But
yeah, it's a bad day for the aliens, Artosis. Yeah.
Who do you actually think takes it between these two?
I mean, this is, I don't know if we should predict anything anymore at this rate.
Well, we certainly
think we've probably
lost
fallen
our
into that
card.
Trap.
I just haven't seen
originally, I would say Gumiho, but I'm really not sure now.
Yeah. Well, Bion has been on such
been a man on fire.
Well, I was going to say more like more recently, he's just not had as good a time, whereas Gumiho has peaked more recently, so that would make you feel Gumiho probably, but I don't know. I mean, the way that Bion played his TVZ and now his TVP, I can see it tastes. I can feel it. I can taste it.
Well, you saw an attempt to try to push in there and do a little bit of damage. Ended up being more of a trade. Bion now going for a Banshee, comboed in with Cloak. And we're having Gumiho getting his Cyclones.
Oh, is he going to do Cyclone Drop, it looks like?
Yeah, he's one of the guys who tinkered, I think, the most with Cyclones. He actually pushed this unit heavily into the meta.
Yeah, him and TY, I think, were really the main linchpins behind
the
Cyclone. It's funny,
the Cyclone was originally a fix-it-all unit. You get like one of them in your base, and it kind of stopped all the annoying stuff that players could do to you. And then we started seeing people push with them, and you know we would say, okay, that makes sense. I mean, it deals damage pretty fast.
It's been patched so many times into this one.
And now it's like, it's just a thing you might as well get a lot of times, you know?
Yeah.
There's a lot of utility to it.
They definitely have very large damage output.
Especially against Cyclones, if you misstep, sometimes the amount of damage that you receive from Cyclones can snowball the game. Mm.
All right, now that Cloaked Banshee coming across from Bion. Oh, boy. Might be able to catch it with these Cyclones.
Oh, wow.
That would be huge, actually.
Oh, my God. He had the right idea. He just didn't quite. Oh! Right, here we go.
Oh, right before Cloak, too. Man. That's a heartbreaker.
That is so brutal.
Right before Cloak. Just moments before Cloak.
Look at that. He has the timing of that so mapped out.
Oof.
He was almost a second off from catching that. But that goes to show you just how advanced Gumiho is and how he's looking at this. He moves right out and says, okay, if you have this unit this time, you're going to take this route, and I can therefore shut it down before Cloak gets there.
And he would have caught, you know, if a medevac was coming or something like that.
Yeah.
He catches.
And no, anything that's airborne at that moment.
Okay, so where are these guys going from here? Big medevac drop moving out. Bion actually attacks in with two Cyclones, and it's hilarious that it's doing damage. This should tell him that Gumiho is elsewhere with his army.
Okay, well, you know, this is actually a pretty nice equalizer here. Because now he sees it's just three Cyclones. No, now he really knows it's just got to be a huge drop coming at him. Is he ready, though? Does he have enough? I guess it depends on where these medevacs are going to unload. We see the scan coming here in the main. Bion immediately reacting, but it looks like Gumiho wants to drop just outside of the scan range.
Yeah, and those tanks. Ooh, I really like that. The Interference Matrix gives him a chance to hold on against this, but those Marines, super strong right now.
Okay, targeting down the tank here. Actually going to get this other tank.
Wow. Will he end up losing both the medevacs, so the two Vikings kind of chasing him down?
This Cyclone's now going on the bunker. These guys going ham on each other this game.
Nine SCVs falling. Looks like these three Cyclones at the front from Gumiho doing some good damage. What?
No, that was kind of odd. Trying to get the targeting to retrace. It looks like he will end up taking out both Vikings.
Wow.
It's so sick. He's getting that Cyclone away.
These Cyclones, just crazy.
Well, I mean, the amount of damage these guys have taken. So we're already way off any normal Terran versus Terran at this point in time.
Yeah,
this is actually going to be probably one of the trickier, I've got Elmer Fudd voice right now, one of the trickier games for both of these guys to play in now. We've had a lot of passive games before in GSL in general where you know, they're very cautious. Maybe we see a Widowmine drop. It gets a few SCVs or one, and it picks up and leaves. Mm-hmm. But the amount that's been traded here is crazy. The worker count's quite even, though. Looks like Bion does have a smaller army. Gumiho's going to try to come in here with a Liberator. Gumiho's trying to keep tempo and keep the attention over here on Bion's side of the base. Keep in mind that those two Vikings earlier on were shot down. The Cyclone's got those. So
yeah, that is a good point. That actually makes the Liberator so much stronger. Look at this. Oh, my God. Getting right in here. He's going to clean up a ton of Marines. Oh, no. He actually unsieges and runs. Oh, he even gets
good
out.
Good play.
Yeah, seriously. Look at that. Five kills already. Oh, poor Bion. He is just being massacred by this harassment.
No way. Okay. Looks like he should get one shot off. Nope.
Not quite. Another good placement, though. So a few more SCVs here.
So this Liberator harass has already done, like, almost too much. Gumiho's expanded behind this. Dude, what if Gumiho gets out of this group? That's so weird.
In first place, nonetheless.
Yeah.
Definitely a possibility at this point.
Wow.
Well, we kind of underestimated him coming in. I mean, he did win his group in the round of 32, right? The one with Scarlet and Patience in it.
Yeah.
He's playing very well today. And that was a sick comeback against SOS. It felt like he was going to go down 0-2, and then he wins the series. Those are always satisfying. Look at this Bion Banshee fly by. So many Vikings.
Yeah,
sorry,
well, this
Banshee.
Is another blow here for Bion. I don't think he should have bothered with that at all, to be honest.
Yeah,
I think the Banshee
like
was never going to do anything, you know?
He's just looking for something. It's some sort of damage, some sort of harassment, and not really finding any at the moment. Moving out with this army now.
Now, Bion, you know, in TBT, especially if you have infantry, sometimes if you get that stim off, you get the right engage at the right time, you can landslide a fight. And nobody's quite as good at that as Bion, but I'm wondering, Gumiho should, by all measure, be ready for this. He's scanning, he's seeing that the army has left. He does pick up, and this looks like this drop may unintentionally spot the push. Yeah, he's gonna see this now. So now he needs to make sure he's got his tanks and everything else in the right position so that he's ready to take this on. And it looks like Bion has to bounce off of that. He's gonna try to find another opening here. Now Gumiho, with a very modest drop, and this is enough to stop the reinforcements. We see that happening now. The reinforcements are gathering up back towards the main. And so that this army that Bion has outside of Gumiho's base, it's not getting any bigger. And note, he's dropping on the side. He's not going to try to go all the way in here and get all the Marines now.
Ooh, barely doesn't get that medevac. But
yeah. But
cleans up the drop, at least.
It's important that he wanted to have the medevac get back out, because he just wants to keep that army stuck inside Bion's base, or Bion won't feel very safe.
Yeah. And feelings of safety are really important. It's like a weird thing, and it's hard to talk about in StarCraft, but trust me, if you have like this little bit where you're like, oh, okay, that medevac's not going to do anything to me for a little bit, you know, that gives you a lot of leeway to not push any attention towards it.
Yeah, it's a big peace of mind.
Yeah.
So Bion's got a position, but it's not a very important one. There's nothing that's going to force Gumiho to expand there. In fact, there's another expansion at the bottom center that he can take. Bion just doesn't quite have enough to really control this game. And Gumiho's been smart. Overall, he's not really moving out. He's got small, like a little drop there or a Liberator coming out, which is just slowing Bion down back at home. Bion was hoping to try to balance this out with a push of his own. And Gumiho doesn't want to fight. He says, no, man. I'm going to stay back and just keep getting bigger.
You know, it's exactly what he should do, because he has 2-2 and ship or vehicle weapons on the way. And when he has all that, like having a 2-upgrade advantage against your opponent's Marines with your Marines, the massacre is real. It's not close. Marines deal damage too quickly, and every armor and every attack upgrade against each other makes a world of difference.
So now Gumiho decides to push out. Small army here. Gumiho knows that this army can be moved very easily at any time. And he's going to make sure that Bion's staying honest. Because of the sensor tower, he's able to do that. You can see that Bion's army is still in the sensor tower on the mini-map. So he's going to try to poke out. Now, even though Gumiho is ahead in workers, he's ahead in supply overall, Bion is doing a good job trying to keep up here. Ooh, man, you got to be careful. An extra tank shot on those Marines.
Taking out that sensor tower, I guess, is nice, but Gumiho definitely has the better tech here. Look at this.
Oh, my God.
Liberator set.
This position's so good.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. And Bion miscalculated that. He actually thought he could come in over there, and maybe gun down the Liberators, and he couldn't quite get it.
Yeah. All right, moving one Liberator into range. Bjorn does get up and snipe that one. Takes a few losses. But, you know, they're both maxing out at a similar time here. There is this window where there's an upgrade advantage for Gumiho. It's been there for a bit, but Bjorn going to catch up at this point, at least on the attack upgrade.
Gumiho right now ready to possibly engage Bjorn here. Bjorn's tanks actually might be in an odd spot. But Bjorn sieges first. Gumiho, respecting that, backs up, sets up his own territory here. The no man land has been created.
And both of them have taken their fourth bases at this point. So, you know, this is a great way for Bjorn to catch up. Definitely in the earlier parts of the game, Gumiho did get an advantage. This harassment was really on
point.
Hold on.
Oh, big hit here. Yep. And this army can't get away. And Gumiho is just wiped out a lot of the army in an engagement that wasn't a trade at all. It was a straight-up win there for Gumiho. Now, Bjorn is going to respond with a drop, but it looks like Gumiho's already aware that could be a real threat. He has something there to shoot that down, and this might end up getting worse.
Whoa.
Whoa.
He's in a lot of trouble there, but maybe he can erase the rest of this army for Gumiho.
No, I think that Gumiho just collapses back.
Yeah. So, Bjorn, he's trying to get something to work out here, trying to get something to happen. But Gumiho's defensive posture is just a bit too much for him.
This
right
is
now.
Such an impressive Terran versus Terran here from Gumiho.
Look at how many Marines Bjorn has, though. He's been up like 20 plus Marines for a big chunk.
Yeah, that is true.
He's really been focusing on that Marine production.
Problem with that is that if you end up eating a few tank shots right away, that Marine number drops so quickly.
And they like that.
Yeah. And actually, the Marines might be able to push through, but you know, there's already, we don't have a shot of it, but in the center right of the map, Gumiho is tearing through this.
Yeah.
And this is enough that I think he might be able to just punt Bjorn into game two with Bjorn having a loss here. This is not a large enough amount of Marines to be a real threat. It can't overcome the production that's inside of Gumiho's main. Now here comes Bjorn's last ditch effort to try to hold this. Can he actually pull it off?
He's killed a lot of SCVs on the other side, so he's sacrificing his own SCVs, but it's not enough. GG. Gumiho taking game one. A player a lot of people are sleeping on right now in this group. He is one map away from advancing.
One GSL Codas victory. Championship, I should say, is not enough for Gumiho.
This is nice to see him playing so well today as well, I gotta say, because,
yeah,
I mean, Gumiho has been a good, strong player for a long time, and he won that GSL. But I think a lot of people might have felt like it's almost like flukish in a way, like he figured out a style of mech against Zerg that no one else could do, no one could really counter at the time. He was just kind of a couple steps ahead everyone. And of course he did kind of reinvent his mechanical play as well, but
yeah,
to see him once again really showing these top tier games, the way that Gumiho is playing today, you can't count him out of the round of eight either if he moves on.
We're going to Dreamcatcher, another new map here. Let's see. This map can encourage a lot of fights. Gumiho looking completely rock solid here. Bjorn, I thought he had a lot of very smart plays, but Gumiho was always one step ahead. Gumiho always had the answer. He always had the position. We're loaded up. The winner of this goes on to the round of eight, the GSL. Everybody staying hydrated here. There's a lot of water being drank.
Psystorm Gaming, Gumiho.
So Dreamcatcher, definitely a very long map. Got some very interesting rocks throughout the center of it. Hard to attack right through early on.
Yeah, you could absolutely reshape this map in a lot of different ways. And Terran versus Terran is probably the most positional matchup. It's always been like that, StarCraft 1, StarCraft 2. It's just, it's very much a fight for territory, you know, but there's an ebb and a flow to it. You can take one area, but then you're going to have to back up, you know, and make sure you're defending the other area. You can't ever cover everything. And what makes it especially interesting is because StarCraft is also a game about growth, assuming you're not like an SOS Gumiho match. You have to keep as you go out further and further, there's going to be more and more vulnerabilities for you. And that's why, you know, what Gumiho did back there was actually take the initiative so well that Byun didn't get to make any choices on the map.
Yeah.
It was you have to answer to Gumiho first.
Well, he took all those initiatives, right? Then he fell back into defensive play, a little bit ahead in every way. Byun kind of caught up, but then was, he got very aggressive. He tried to get those four medevacs through. He got a chunk of his army caught up at the top. And from there, it was, you know, pretty straightforward for Gumiho to clean it. So a quicker command center here from Gumiho. Byun teching up very quickly, just finished his factory.
Yeah, and we, of course, have to see what Byun can actually, you know, really do with this.
Well, this particular one, if I recall correctly, right, you run across with two Reapers and a Hellion, and it gets there before the Cyclone is out. So I believe that's what we're going to end up seeing. You can definitely put some decent pressure on with that. Oh, my God, Gumiho actually on top of things. Going to make a bunker, which will just shut it down 100% instantly.
Yeah, this is actually a very, very cool response here to something, even before it's even happened here. Look at this. It's going to finish right when they get to the ramp.
And this little timing is actually kind of old, the one that Byun is using.
Yeah.
But definitely something that can work.
Well, the thing is, sometimes if you use an old build, it gets discarded in the player's minds.
Look at that.
Look at that control.
Oh, my God.
Damn.
That depot is awesome, too. It stopped an instant jump up into the main base. Like, great defense from Gumiho here. Really fantastic.
So Byun forced to back off. His command center is going to be finishing a little bit later without really doing too much to seize control of the game.
I'm going to try to scout.
And it looks like it's barely taken out. But, you know, it did see what it needed to see.
That's worth a Reaper right now. You see the timing of the starport. You see where the starport's going, which is the tech lab. Not like that's a huge surprise.
Well, you know, it's good usage of the Reaper because that's an auto unit that's great as the game goes on.
Yeah.
In TVT.
Really in any match, unless you're Byun.
Well, that's what's funny about Byun is there was a whole period where he just kept making them early on and winning all these weird games. And
you remember when he was just, like, bouncing Banelings away late game?
Yeah.
That was so crazy.
Yeah.
The Reaper actually got nerfed because of Byun, and I won't let anyone at Blizzard tell me anything otherwise. Straight up nerf to Byun.
You have to imagine Blizzard watching that going, okay, well, we didn't think it was going to be able to do that, but I guess if you're that good at controlling that many Reapers, I guess.
Yeah. He was the only one that could do it, too.
I guess we won't have late-game Terran anymore. If Byun still keeps playing this game, we're going to have to do something about this. Look at that. Ooh.
That's so funny. It bounces
down.
Oops. Loses that Hellion. But Cloak going to be finishing up here for Byun. Look at that. He stops his Banshee. He's not interested in losing it to three Marauding Cyclones.
And so with Cloak on the way, we'll see if he can actually get in there. Now, remember, in the last game, Gumiho came out and shot down the Banshee right away. And we already see his Cyclones moving into a position. It's going to be much tougher for Byun to get a lot done here. There's a Raven here as well.
Yeah.
So
makes the Cloak almost not worthwhile. Gumiho going to go into mech this game. Double Armory coming up. So a lot of Cyclones going to be shown. He's making another Raven as well, so anti-armor missiles as well as interference matrix is going to be very powerful here.
Pretty bold move here by Byun to be making the command center on the low ground. But I guess he's confident that Gumiho's not going to push out. You know, with mech, traditionally we would say that you don't move out that much, but the Cyclone's kind of made mech a little bit. It's changed the way we understand it. So
Cyclone mech is battle mech. You're out there, you're actually looking for fights because it is a strong unit early on.
So in the early days of StarCraft, mech originally meant that you were gonna stay back, you're gonna make mechanical units, you're gonna get tanks. You can't do a lot with it early on, but if you get to where you're almost maxed out, you can do so much more damage on the map.
Yeah.
That a lot of times, you know, the passive game plays off. But yeah, with the Cyclone, you can actually move out. Original mech wasn't mobile, so that's why we see that now. And these are going to be the two forks in the road as far as unit composition. Yeah. To put it simply, I mean, there is more complexity to it than that if you really try to break it down, like branches of each of those forks.
Sure.
But it's one player going for bio here that has the ability to change positions very quickly, to pick up and move with ease. Whereas mech, it can be, even with cyclones, can be a little bit slower. You know, stim marines are much faster than pretty much everything else and deal damage quite quickly. But you can end up getting in a position where if you're just going to be able to destroy a base, they sometimes can't do much about it.
Well, Bianna actually doesn't know about the mech at this point. Like, he got up with the Reaper again, but didn't see the factories, and the armories are actually behind the naturals. So, like, I mean, he might suspect it. I'm not certain about that. I'm seeing Marauders being produced, so that kind of makes me think he knows slash suspects that it's mech, because if you're going Marine Tank, you don't want Marauders in your army generally. They just don't have the same damage output as Marines.
These Banshees really haven't paid for themselves at all.
No, they've
been
pretty lackluster.
This is kind of the weird thing about the Banshee. When you make it and you get cloaked, you need it to kill stuff, or you don't really have a good investment. Kind of weird to see him just flying around with cloak on. I mean, this is eventually going to burn out as far as energy goes, and then he's going to have to wait a while.
Yeah. Well, he couldn't get anything done anyways, it seems. So, going to go home with those Banshees for now. Bjorn is going to have to get out on the map pretty quickly here. His 1-1 and Stim is going to be finishing, but he's playing against mech, and it's 3-base versus 3-base, so Gumiho is going to get extremely scary soon.
Yeah, and I think you're completely correct, by the way, that he needs to be out on the map, because right now they're both just sitting back at home. The mech player moves out and gets a good position. I mean, the Terran player gave up the assets his units had, you know?
And it's you know...
But maybe the way the reason why he's doing this is because he got completely owned in everywhere he went on the map last time. Like, last time he moved out, and it was just like he's getting Hulk smashed over here.
Monster
punched to the moon over there. And look at this sneaky play.
Yeah, I like
Bjorn it. Bjorn just takes like the gold base. We've been seeing this a little bit more in StarCraft, too.
Well, you know what? He's a more mobile player and stuff. If he keeps the pressure on, that gold base could definitely pay off.
Yeah. Taking one of these hidden bases, it can really be worth it. Mm. Sometimes players just don't check. But as I'm saying that, I think we're about to see Gumiho check. He's sending Hellions over here.
Checked the wrong place.
Yeah. The idea was there. Bjorn begins to move out, and we are waiting to see this happen.
Mm. Now, he's got his own siege tank, so you know that makes these engagements a lot more interesting.
I think he's
siege
about to lock.
Can be good here.
Yeah. I think he's just locked Gumiho out of actually expanding here.
Well, Gumiho has two Ravens, so he can actually interference matrix all the tanks.
Very true.
And if he does that, he can easily barge into this situation, especially if he throws down an anti-armor missile.
That's unfortunate. He wasn't able to stop the command center at all. Well, no, hold on. Now he's moving back.
Does Bjorn really want to do it right now?
Okay, so I think he does. He just wants to get in here and make sure this expansion can't be taken, but he needs to get out pretty quickly.
Yeah,
he needs to reposition.
That's good. He did great there.
And look at that. These Banshees are going to get a depot, Artosis.
Wow,
things are looking up.
Jeez. 2-2 is almost done here for Gumiho. He's definitely got a super scary. I mean, look at that. 4 medevacs full of Hellbats to drop on top of the bio. Okay, let's see this. Going to push forward with the Vikings. Should be seeing some interference matrixes, I think. I feel like with this 2-2 done, you can go and break all this.
You know, keeping this army over here does sort of draw attention away from that upper right. Hold on. Gumiho's going to try to come through now. Now, Bjorn's backing up. Uh-oh, he doesn't want to lose that Raven. Oh, man.
Whoa, anti-armor missile everywhere. Yeah. On both sides, really. And Gumiho smashes through that set of tanks.
Small amount of Bjorn's army escapes over here to the left. Gumiho scans, decides to actually not go and try to close it out. Instead, he's going to snap attack across to the right side of the map. He says that army's not big enough. With this small group of medevacs, he can unload on them, but he wants to try to get position. Now, Bjorn's remade another army. He's going to try to move out.
Look at this. Bjorn keeping that pressure on the left side. Of course, Gumiho can't get through those rocks too easily. Bjorn didn't destroy them.
And I think that was a smart play by Bjorn.
Yeah.
He's making Gumiho take the long way around. Now, I don't know about this position here. There it is.
Great anti-armor missile, but are there enough units? It looks like there are.
Wow. Is Gumiho going to press forward even more? Now, here's a nice drop by Bjorn over in the main. And the moment that Gumiho comes to respond to that, he picks up. He's going to look for an opening elsewhere. Gumiho's army, it is thinning out as it moves across the map. It's getting smaller, but in some ways, the units are just better.
Yeah.
And again, with mech, the goal is that you try to get into the position, and eventually the Terran can't keep running away, can't keep trying to do these little guerrilla tactics over here.
Look at that, dropping the Hellbats all over. It just will demolish that little set of bio
there. If Gumiho gets any further in here, I think it's going to be checkmate.
Getting close to it.
Oh, wow, and he's got a lot more coming down.
Stallions are definitely going to be deadly. Oh, he's actually picking off some of these siege tanks, so that's nice. The Blue Flame Hellions, in the meantime, have definitely killed a lot of SCVs over here.
Bjorn may be able to fend this off, but with more tanks coming down here now, there's no way that he can even get medevacs with his army. Yeah, that I think is just too much, man.
Oh, man.
Oh, my God, and he just scanned the gold base up there. The only other thing he had going for him.
Yeah, and when this gets attacked, I think Bjorn might just GG it. He's just got no economy left. Yeah, he's got, like, no SCVs. It's natural right now, even.
Okay, well, yeah, you got to remember that this is Bjorn, and sometimes he does keep.
That's true.
If he has units, he can keep controlling. He will stay in the game.
Indeed.
But, yeah, I mean, we're getting close to the stake in the heart for Bjorn. Gumiho is about to get up to where the production facilities are. There's basically no economy anymore for Bjorn. Workers are going down. There's no viable expansions that he has that are mining.
Yeah,
50 workers have just recently been killed. Somehow Bjorn still has 33, though. And, you know, Gumiho, with very patient play, he waited. He saw Bjorn push out. He smashed it. Pushed across the map, and that's GG, and Gumiho gets out first.
All right, Gumiho wins this group.
What's a couple of world champions and arguably the best Protoss in the whole of StarCraft II right now? No. It's Gumiho that gets out first.
Gumiho.
Get these world champions out of my face. I got to get to the round of eight.
Well, he's going right up there. I'm sure Systrom Gaming very happy with their player. This guy continues to bring the results. And that means he gets first seed, which means he's against second place from our last group, which was, let's see, Classic got first, TY got second, right? So, Gumiho TY. Whoa, that's a nice TBT, isn't it?
I'll take it.
And definitely, TY plays a very different TBT than these guys, so it's a good match.
Gary says, first player to advance is Gumiho. Congratulations, thank you.
네, 모두가 빌드마스터 하는 이유가 있는 것 같습니다. 먼저 오늘 1위 소감 들어볼게요.
The Koreans have nicknamed you the Buildmaster.
정말 열심히 준비했거든요. 그런데 이제 그
I really put a lot of prep in these matches here today.
하지만 이제 또 우승을 위해서는
I'm really happy that I managed to push through.
그래서 이제 그 점에 대해서 생각하고 있었어요.
But even today, I feel like I saw some mistakes in my play, and especially against Protoss, so I still think I still have some more work to do. So after the last patch, we thought we'd see more Bionic plays from Terran, but you seem to stick more with Mech, and it looks quite strong. Can you tell us about that?
버프가 된 점도 있어가지고 테테전에서 메카닉도 여전히 좀 쓸만하다고 생각하고 있고요.
네.
그리고
In terms of TBT, I think Mech Terran is still overall better.
네, 오늘
but Bio versus Bio,
I
still have confidence in that as well. So let's talk about your winner's match against Bjorn.
It
seems like you've really studied him quite well. You seem to understand what he was going to do every move, and you're able to stop it.
100% 장담은 못하지만 어쨌든 이제 움직이는데 손해는 없잖아요.
Well, I wasn't 100% guaranteed that I'd be able to respond to how he played, but I did go out there and try to check. I think I was able to predict what angle he would attack in it. I spent a lot of time studying Bjorn's previous games.
그런 걸 좀 잘 알고 있었어요.
I think he has some habits that he likes to attack into. So let's talk about your match against the Protoss player SOS. After you lost the first map, you started doing these proxy builds. What was going on there?
이유가 있었는데 다크니스에서 지고 나서 사실 제가 연습할 때는 항상 그
Yeah, I was actually pretty upset when I lost
the
first game. I figured if I failed scouting early on.
센터를 안 거치고 가로로 갔어요.
네.
근데 딱 대각에 아니 그 센터에 건물이 있는 거 보고 너무 화나가지고 사실 준비한 게 있었는데 두 번째 세 번째 그냥 올인을 치게 됐어요. 너무
Usually, he said he scouts diagonal directions.
손가락 대로 하자 이 생각을 했는데 그게 좀 잘 먹혔던 것 같아요 오히려.
네, 화나서 저
Basically, I got tilted and said I decided to just go all in. I felt that my hands were going to work better with, excuse me, work better with an all in.
그런 배제하지 않고 모든 그 고병재 선수의 선택들을 다
서치하고 이렇게 막아내고 이러면서 굉장히
So it seems like SOS was searching really hard everywhere.
그 일회전 판단이 정말
He spotted some parts of your proxy.
건설로프까지 다 동원해 가지고 나갈 때는 네. 내가 이긴다
But you had really good decision
making.
And you went for that base trade. Can you tell us about that?
되게 그러니까 그 경기도 실수가 많았던 게 베럭스가 원래 본진으로 아 병영이 본진으로 돌아가고 있었는데
To be honest, I think I made a lot of mistakes on that map as well.
그 게임도 약간 정신이 없었는데 그 와중에도 네. 이제 상대 본진을 계속 확인을 했는데 황원우가
It was a really tough game to manage. There were so many things going on at the same time.
그래서 시간 주면 이제 발업되고 이러면 못 이기니까.
네.
All I thought is if I give him more time.
정신 없었지만 운도
He's gonna have upgrades. He's gonna have more answers. So I decided I should go for a base trade.
네. 바위를
And I felt like I also got a little bit lucky back there. Because I spotted his probe,
아니, 그 당시에는
which was running away.
추적자의 후속이 잘리지 않게 위에서 부었는데 네. 갑자기 상대가 엘리전을 하더라고요. 그래서 네. 그때부터 이제 도망치는 프로브를 다 잡으려고 집중을 많이 했는데 그걸 다
So all of a sudden SOS agreed to do the base trade. So I thought it was most important 네, I kill the workers first and I think that was what was key
자,
to not let him get back on his feet.
보여주시고, 이렇게 1위로
well, they were very entertaining games to watch.
8강에서 만나는 상대가 시조의 2위
So in the quarterfinals
You're
going to meet
네,
TY.
다행이라고 생각하고
It's going to be another TVT.
2등으로 올라가면 올라가도 지옥이라고 생각은 했거든요. 제가 진짜
네. Yeah, I'm very excited to be facing another Terran.
레더에서도 많이 졌던 선수라서.
네.
그래서
I knew if I had to get out of the group as second place, I would have had to face Classic in the bracket. So I wanted to make it out of the group first. It was very important for me to get out. So I'm pleased with my results.
고병재 선수는 참 이 테란 같은 테란으로서 좋은 빌드를 많이 만들어줘서 참 담비 같은 선수다, 고마운 존재다 이렇게 이야기를 했다고 해요. 전태양 선수에 대한 생각은 어떠세요?
전태양 선수 되게 좀 테테전도 까다롭게 하고 전태양 선수도 빌드 잘 만드시는데
So they're talking about how Gumiho's always created great builds. I'm sorry, I didn't catch the rest.
It's helpful to Terran because he builds so many builds.
Oh, yeah.
사실 저는 진짜 조성주 선수랑 하면 했지 저는 프로토스랑 오전 삼성대 정말 별로 하고 싶지가 않아요.
네.
진짜 연습하는 게 너무 지옥이어가지고
Honestly, he said rather face Mario than face any Protoss.
연습할 때가
I just hate facing Protoss right now.
네, 그래서 다행이라고 생각하고 있어요.
아, 오늘
My practice against Protoss isn't good right now. So, anyways, I'm relieved to just keep facing Terrans and try to get deeper into the tournament.
불안해하셨을지 생각이 됩니다. 자, 다시 한번 축하드리겠습니다. 그럼 마지막으로 팬들에게
So once again, congratulations. Before we close, is there anything else you'd like to say?
토스전이 약해서 걱정 많이 하셨을 텐데 열심히 해서 이제 올라갔고.
I know a lot of you guys have been worried about my TVP, but
결승까지.
Since I'm facing other Terrans in the quarterfinals, I think it's going to be an easy road to the semifinals. Please keep supporting me. Thank you so much.
All right.
Sweet.
Well, good on Gumiho.
Yeah.
Winning that group, definitely not what I was expecting coming into today.
Yeah.
But next, we have a great PvP.
Yeah, in the losers match, Stats and SOS, that's weird to say. One of them is going to be eliminated, Artosis.
Yeah.
And not be deep in our tournament.
Very sad stuff.
Huh.
You never expect Stats to go out this early. Sometimes SOS gets out in the round of 32. Sometimes he gets out in the finals. Who knows? He's kind of up and down.
This is probably the hardest tournament for SOS. PvP with these two guys, I got no idea. We're going to go to a short break. When we come back, we'll eliminate our first player in Group D of the GSL Code S.
The world, now let's watch it burn.
I just want a life that seems
once when I gave my
아프리카 TV에는 당신이 아는 것보다 다양한 인종이 살고 있죠. 말 많은 인종, 발 빠른 인종, 잘 먹는 인종, 영리한 인종, 친절한 인종까지. 모든 게 컨텐츠가 되고 누구나 주인공이 되는 세상. 알고 보면 멋진 세상.
Are you free? Africa TV.
Stop what you're doing right now. Have a seat, okay? You got two monitors. Hey, eyes over here on us.
Indeed.
You're studying while you do this? Put the pen down. There are important things happening here.
You have a paper due tomorrow?
Tomorrow's
yeah. Tomorrow.
Today is today. Oh, I got to study. Oh, what are you going to do? You going to fail the test? Oh, no. Big deal. All right?
Big deal.
Big deal, okay? Let's talk about things that matter.
Yeah.
SOS, the two-time. It's not just Dr. Disrespect. It's SOS as well. World champion. Going up against Stats, who we argue, I think many argue, is the most solid Protoss player that's out there. One of these guys is apparently unworthy. Unworthy.
Apparently.
Unclean of the round of eight. We got to get rid of him.
The round of eight, I love it.
What world am I in now? By the way, Gumiho's out of this group. He was going around like that killer in No Country for Old Men. Like, he doesn't even use the coin. He just kills everybody and moves on.
Yeah.
Gets that money. So we're going to start this off on Lost and Found. Two very different Protosses.
Indeed, they are. Once upon a time, I would guarantee an SOS victory, but Stats over the last, I don't know, 5 months or so, 4 months maybe, has really cleaned up his PvP.
Yeah.
His PvP looked actually to be pretty bad. It was his worst matchup for a while there. He was getting smashed by every other top. I tried to do that in one breath. By every other top Protoss. But now he mixes it up. He has some very sharp, decisive moves. That being said, SOS is the ultimate god of PvP, and if he loses, it's a fluke.
Our game's loaded up. SOS versus Stats, a fight to survive in the GSL.
Fight!
Jin Air Green Wings, SOS.
He is the most understanding of the PvP players.
Oh, whoa. Yes! Yes, a counter rush, yes! Oh!
It's been so long since we had a cannon rush in GSL.
Okay, Shine's trying to show us where he thinks it's going to be, just below the minerals and then pushing onto the high ground. Now, a lot of players just don't check for this because it's kind of considered.
He's checking.
Uh-oh. Okay, well, that's good he checked.
Just because you check doesn't mean that you stop it. Okay? Like, checking is only the beginning of the battle, as Printf will tell you, and all of his opponents will tell you as well. Puts his own forge out now. That's how you stop a cannon rush.
Okay, so
okay,
he makes
so
another pylon
stats,
there.
No. That's an SOS pylon. So stats threw a forge down, blocked the probe from leaving, then canceled it because the pylon outside got canceled. Now, when he canceled it, SOS decided to block him from leaving, which didn't make sense, so he canceled that as well. Anyways, I'm so sad that this didn't work. And I'm sure that, you know.
I think we can all at least take joy in how happy you were for that brief moment,
well,
though.
Well, you know, you never, ever see it. And especially in this day and age, you start with this many probes and stuff.
When's the last time we had it in a major match? Was it with the Partying, I think?
In a PvP? I'm not sure.
Oh, no. It was a PvZ.
Yeah, PvZ maybe. We haven't seen it there either for a long time. But, like, especially in PvP now, because you have to make the gateway wall in at the front, it just makes it harder, right? When everyone's gates were near their nexus, because people were lazy about walling in because you didn't have to because the Mothership Core would deal with the depths. It was a different time, and you saw a lot more cannon rushes. But since this new iteration of the Mothership Core, you don't see cannon rushes.
You know, a big chunk of our viewership was excited. They're like, now I'm going to learn how to stop this.
Yeah.
Sometimes when you start playing, man, people online are not doing what the pros are doing. There's a whole other low-tier meta
If you play on the ladder, you will get cannon rush from time to time. Definitely scout for it. And the fact that stats scouts for it is super hilarious because you're right. Like, a lot of times people just won't scout for it. They're just like, nah, it's like not even good anymore. But he does, and so SOS can't do it. And so hold on. Hold the phone, right? I guess that he got scouted quickly enough? Is this right, that SOS actually canceled his own forge?
Oh, I believe he did cancel it, yeah.
Yeah, okay. I was, like, so caught up in being excited about seeing SOS kill stats with cannons.
Now, I think if there's any player that can put together a build after having the cannon rush denied, not so much that it started, but because it was scouted, SOS nixed it. But I'm curious to see where SOS takes the game from here. Because I think he's a guy who can actually pull it off.
Well,
but right now, Stats is hitting these Adepts pretty hard.
Nice body block there. Messed up with the shades just slightly. It's kind of a heavy micro move. He's just going Blink, whereas Stats is going Oracle Harass into a Nexus. So, I mean, you look at the two builds, to be honest, like, I think the Oracle opener is a little bit better. Anytime you can open Oracle, it's like pretty awesome.
He should get workers no matter what, and you can see Stats was pressuring at the front there. So it's drawn all of SOS's stalkers down now.
Ooh, yeah, look at that. No shield battery to help out here. So three kills. Still, that's quality. Now he's got like great scouts. Oh, SOS gets two Adepts in! Two Adepts is the perfect number!
And this is actually a great way to counterbalance this. The damage he's already received is going to be evened out here.
Yeah, he loses the Adepts, but that was nice still. Luckily for Stats, one of them was already heavily damaged from the Stalker chase down. If that hadn't been the case, then we would have seen a lot more probes die there. So you need to one-shot them. They have to shoot their volleys at the same time, or the shield battery will save them.
So Blink is on the way. Robo's just now finished here for Stats, and he's going to start stacking Immortals for some time, which is, of course, a great response to a player who's amassing a bunch of Stalkers.
Yeah.
And with the Oracles here, I mean, Stats is definitely playing a really good game. These Oracles are keeping the Stalkers inside the base, and Stats is continuing to grow and get, in a lot of ways, a more complex army. Oh, my God!
Ooh,
okay,
sick catch right there.
Yep, Blink finishing just in time.
One Oracle makes its way out, so now, nice save from Stats.
Check this out. SOS is making a beeline to the south here, but there's already one Immortal.
Yeah.
The Guardian Shield, you're not that worried about
here?
Your Stalkers versus their Stalkers.
No. Did he make a...
Maybe, can he try to Blink in the main here?
No, he doesn't have
anything. No, yeah, there's nothing that can get up there.
Like, he didn't make a Sentry early on, I don't believe.
I didn't see one.
And so, like, this, he's really not going to do anything. Not with
like,
the shield
sorry, I was
there,
just checking to make sure you're way ahead. Okay, I just wanted to make sure. Yep, you're definitely way ahead.
Yeah, see, some fancy micro and all, but Stats is going to be all right. He's making a lot of Immortals. He already has his Forge. Okay, so this is how this game is going, right? Into charge and a third Nexus. What we want to see out of SOS is massive amounts of gateways. Like, he needs to go just lots of gateway units. because he's never going to catch the immortal count of stats. He's not going to catch the upgrades of stats, right? Stats is going to have higher quality, so SOS needs higher quantity.
Well said. So, SOS staying back for now.
I'm doing this funny thing with my casting today where I'm trying to make intelligent, succinct statements with one breath. And I keep doing it, and I just barely got that one out. And the one before, I was like, oh, God,
I
tried to do that one breath.
I thought he was going to monster punch him all the way to the moon.
That was you said earlier. I thought that was the most accurate thing.
Yeah, people talk about Shakespeare a little bit too much, I think. What about Artosis?
He was just the Artosis of his time.
Yeah.
People are going to wonder in a few hundred years if I was multiple people.
Yeah. And if they put monkeys in a room with a typewriter for, you know, a million years, would they come up with Artosis statements? You know, would they randomly
I think it would only take 2-3 years and 2-3 monkeys, to be honest. I think you don't give monkeys enough credit, or you give me too much.
I don't know about this game for SOS Artosis. I understand the direction he's taking it. I think this is going to be tough, man. I think Stats is getting to play the game he wanted to play. The Hallucinated Phoenix has come in here. It's going to see that absolutely SOS is amassing a really big army.
Well, the really crucial piece of this is the fact that Stats is getting his third base at a reasonable time, and he got a very quick Templar Archives, because the Archons are going to be really key. He's already got the Immortals, but to have the Archons added in as well is so important. Because, again, it's like SOS just has to count on the amounts of units. But SOS will have some tactics to try to catch up as well, right? He's trying to catch up strategically by using something that can fight against the higher quality of his opponent. What he's going to have to do from here, in my opinion, is get a Warp Prism and get Stats out of position somewhere.
Yeah, I think so, because he can't fight this army head-to-head.
Yeah, like,
but you know,
100% Stats wins that.
But the thing is, Stats has got, as we say, like the best defense out there. So
yeah,
it's going to be quite a feat.
It's certainly an uphill battle for SOS, but yeah. He is the type of person that gets this type of situation to work out. Okay, he's going double Forge from here. So that's his long-term game plan. But this Prism is everything. He needs to make it do serious, serious work. Oh, look at Stats turn around against 3 Stalkers. Look at that.
You're not going to get my pylon! Ah.
And look, he's flanking
as
well.
Was maybe not
but
worth it.
This is such an important moment in this game, actually. The units from Stats would be at the third base just about now if those 3 Stalkers hadn't come in, right? So these 3 Stalkers have been worth their weight in gold here. Oh, wow. The recall, and he gets one
right,
out.
Gets getting that value.
Jeez.
Here comes a big warp in now. Stats able to take the initiative. But you know what? SOS with a great shutdown. These Zealots really don't do anything. So this is actually a great trade. But Stats is moving across the map. The Warp Prism unintentionally spots the army.
And he already used his recall, so he can't even get his army over here to the third base. Like, Stats can get in a position. Oh, he actually doesn't.
No, I think he had a decent amount over there. I think there were some Archons and some other stuff.
Oh, and a few units left over? Okay. Now the Prism, can he get Stats to turn around? Because this army is just, it's got +2. It's got 3 Immortals. There's no Immortals in the other army. Look how many Stalkers there are. What are those going to do? What are those going to tickle? They're going to tickle the Archons or
okay.
The Zealots?
Here we go. Now a lot of the Zealots can't quite get up into the front. The War Prism juggling here by Stats is doing very well. Now some of these, no, he's just too good. I shouldn't even try. It looks like SOS is going to get run over here by Stats. Again, he elected to try to go for a cannon rush. It was spotted, and SOS tried to bring a different game. Stats goes ahead, and he's going to close this one out. And SOS is going to have to bring something better, or he's going to be out of the GSL.
Yeah, that's a crazy thing to say, but it happens from time to time.
GG.
Okay, so Stats takes down game one, but SOS, he was trying to be cheeky. He tried a couple comeback strategies there, but Stats was exacting in his play. Exacting. He scouted the potential cannon rush, and he went into Oracle immediately, knowing that all tech from SOS is now slowed, right? That's an important part. Also, I want to point out the fact that he showed this cannon rush early. Well, I'll talk about that after. Not only did he like follow up correctly with the Immortals, with the Forge, he's like, okay, my quality is higher, right?
Right.
He got his third in time, he got the Archons, he hit a push just on time. It was awesome, but with SOS, with that, the way that looked, what if he brings out another pylon that gets scouted and tries to make it look like it's super real, but he's actually just teching?
That's a good point.
Right.
It would
that's
be a good way to play a best of three.
I just wonder. Because
well, let's not forget, though, the disrespect here from SOS.
Ooh.
Going for the cannon rush to get Stats, the most stable player. Trying to style on him, trying to clown on him.
It's clowning.
Let's see what happens now, man. Gonna go to game number two. And let's see.
Don't clown on Stats.
He's trying to dab on him.
Oh, my God.
He got his fidget spinners out.
Dude.
Come on.
This guy
he
here.
He tried to cannon rush him, then take a half-filled water bottle Jim and flip Green it and make it land up, right
SOS.
Side up.
And you know what happened? This guy right here, the moon tastes. He got monster punch to it.
The moon, that's right, man. I mean, was cannon rush Stats. Okay.
Splice Stats.
It's like you've got Houdini, and you're like trying to show him how to make a quarter disappear in his hand, you know?
Yeah.
You're like, it was in my sleeve, man. Look, he's gonna. He's like,
he's checks
anything?
Again.
All right, just making sure.
He didn't actually check all the way.
Well, I guess he's fine with it. I mean, it's not coming, so he's okay.
Yeah. Man, I'm still heartbroken about that cannon rush. And then Stats' is like finishing of him was just too precise, man.
Yeah.
Like, he made all the moves right, and SOS is like, oh, I'm dead. Oh, damn.
Don't ever do that in a game against me again.
Yeah.
This is where if they were practicing online, he's like, listen, I'm practicing for a GSL. You can't waste my time.
Yeah.
There's only time for so many games in a day. Do a real build. Do a real strategy. Probe comes in. Going to do a quick scout here. Cybernetic scores are about to finish, and then we're really going to see what direction do they take it. I mean, there's so many different ways to play a PvP.
Indeed.
Especially early on.
Well, I thought you were going to elaborate on that.
No, no, no.
There's so many ways to play a PvP. I'm like, yes, just as many as there are ways to skin a cat, as they say, right?
You know, you do have to wonder, you know, with SOS yet to be a GSL Codex champion, and he's lost, there's been so many GSL Codexes, right?
Yeah.
We've had so many, and he's won everything else, including the world championship.
And he's even been to the finals twice.
Yeah, and you know, this is a tough tournament for him. It really is interesting. It seems like it is tougher for him, even though he can get very deep, and there's really no player that can always beat SOS, right? It looks like he might get shut down here again today, and I think a lot of this is going to go back to that haunting cannon rush. I mean, he did roll the dice. Nobody's making you do that.
Yeah.
You are taking a risk. I think it was a pretty intelligent risk. But, you know, you can get eliminated. Got to wait till next season.
Well, look at the builds this time. It looks like the Twilight Blink from Stats. He made the Twilight before his Nexus. And SOS did two interesting things. He made a Sentry right away, which will give him a really quality scout. And he's going for Oracle, right? Now, I wonder if he's going to do this thing where you send in like a hallucination first or something. I occasionally see something funny like that where it's like, okay,
yeah.
A hallucinated Oracle comes in, your opponent overreacts, you're like, oh, you don't have Oracle. Okay, I don't even worry, right? And then the real Oracle comes in. Could be. Or you come in with both like you're playing against a Zerg.
Stats has brought his Stalkers back. Ready for anything that could come in here to try to threaten this. Here comes the hallucinated Phoenix. And the Oracle is way north of this. Up here.
Hey, well, he saw where the units are, and he sees what the tech is.
And he might stay back. You don't have to show the Oracle right away.
Yeah, and it's fine to pool it into two, right? Because
yeah.
If there's a defensive shield battery or something, it does zero against two Oracles.
Yeah, and with the two Oracles, you just one-shot the workers.
It's crazy that it's like one Oracle against a shield battery. The shield battery wins, but two Oracles, like the shield battery, does zero at all.
The shield battery becomes a waste of money.
Yeah.
Okay, so Blink's coming up here for Stats. And now SOS is making his own Robo.
Ooh, Stats with a couple of depths coming in.
Oh. Ooh, nice denial.
Yeah, good block.
Wow, very nicely handled here by SOS. Trying to shade in again. Looks like this should be blocked. In fact, he never even canceled the pylon. Here come the Oracles.
Four
and
kills.
He's just going for it. Five,
very
six.
Good micro.
Now, Blink's, it's almost done.
Ooh.
He can get it.
Okay.
Wow.
Well, he loses 2 for 7 as opposed to 2 adepts
he's
for 4.
But he's going to have to remake another Oracle because he needs to tech Sockers and Blink's been upgraded.
Mm.
So it would have been much more beneficial had he actually gotten out.
Yeah.
Seems like he would be able to time that, though, you know.
Yeah, like I think he probably could have gotten out there, but he was really trying to do maximum damage. And the thing is with SOS, you know, you killed 2 Oracles. You might not think that they're going to make another one because they have to catch up on other techs. But he has another one now. So we'll see if he maybe gets more damage this time with it. Has a couple of depths ready as well. If you get them both into the same location at once, that can definitely be helpful. Also, the depths can tank a ton of damage compared to the Oracle.
Okay. Looks like the adepts are coming in now. Gonna go ahead and try to get this Oracle, but they now shade into the main. There's, you know, a decent number of stalkers here. And it looks like he's gonna get about 3 kills, and then that's gonna be that.
Yeah, Blink, and that's not gonna work at all.
Oh no.
These poor
stalkers.
It'd
be nice if you can get more than the shields off here. You can see he's trying to buy time.
They're scared, Tasteless.
Oh. Well, that's actually not bad getting 3 of those out there, even though one's almost to 1 HP.
SOS was actually a little bit slow to react. He definitely could have killed 2 more.
Oh, wow, he remade this? Okay, there we go. I was going to say. It's not worth it, man. So tagging the Stalkers is what's key. Now, there's 6 more gateways coming here for SOS. He does have Immortals incrementing out. Remember, in that last big fight, he wasn't able to get that. It was just Stalkers and Archons. And Immortals are one of the most important units, sometimes in any matchup, but especially in PvP. They're kind of an all-around good unit against everything. I guess not Zealots, but that's what the Archons are for.
Yeah.
The Archons are there to just, you know, bleach out the Zealots as they come in.
Look at SOS sitting here. He's going into Glaives. I really love that.
Yeah, that's a cool play.
Yeah, that's a really cool, smart play. Like, there is still a place for Glaived Depths in this matchup. You can hit it certain times, and then suddenly, you know, they do okay against low numbers of Archons. And they can wreck Zealots before you hit that critical mass of charge. So he has a Prism on the way, getting ready for this massive, massive attack. Oh my god! Once again, the Oracle comes in. I guess it doesn't get that much done, though.
Yeah, he has the energy, so he might as well spend it. Here comes that Phoenix now getting that. So he's going to recall that back home. So no more recalls for a little while. I don't think we all need one necessarily coming up here. Both these guys very passive. I mean, stats with the bare minimum to try to keep pressure on here. Stats did get a little bit of the initiative early on. But SOS seems to be moving out now. I mean, with both of them having more prisms, that's absolutely an option. Whether you want to try to attack in one area, like at an expansion, and then use the warp prism to warp inside of their main. Or if you want to use that warp prism to just reinforce 1 point because you think you just have a better army. But this triggers Stats to try to come in, which forces a warp in over here. And that's when Stats is going to back out.
Yeah.
And this is keeping any growth rate outside the map under control.
Yeah, you got to
be careful
about
that. You see all those adepts, you're like, okay, I know exactly what's coming on here.
Yeah, the fact that you chose adepts automatically.
It's like, oh, you didn't get stalkers.
Tells
you didn't
want
to try to shoot my. Okay.
Yeah, look at this. He's really trying to get some Archons out to help out against these.
Okay, so he gets the block there.
Now, this is cool because, look, the Warp Prism. This is so key in an attack
like this.
You need to have all your army basically in the same place, but if you drop Immortals into the main, man, it helps out a lot. Here, you don't even want to kill that pylon because the Archons can't get in. Okay, he's going to pop him in, though. In the meantime, a shade in.
Okay, he's now hitting from 2 different sides right now. The Stalkers are coming forward.
SOS starting to get some damage done on this probe line for sure.
Yeah, but can he keep it going? Again, these depths don't have easy escapes until their shades are ready.
No, yeah, the shades.
And with the Archon here, this is a lot of damage on these adepts. Oh, they need to get out.
Oh, he canceled the shade.
Oh,
huh?
Wow, yeah.
Okay.
Even Shine was looking for it, our observer.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, you know, is the equity of adepts going to last? I'm not sure.
If the armies stay reasonably small, the adepts are still good fighting units here, right? When it gets really big, the adepts become kind of trashy, but.
Trashy?
Yeah.
Yeah. No, they're not as good. I think they're kind of dumpy, Artosis, personally.
Yeah.
So
they need to take care of themselves, Tasteless.
Yeah,
it's just they don't. They don't scale well, you know?
Stats is
like those adepts were so good in high school, man, but
you know, they didn't
not anymore.
That's what happens when you're popular too young.
You think you're gonna kill everything in 2 shots forever. It's not the case.
Certainly not. Now Stats is gonna try to come out here. Keep in mind Stats has a 3rd base up. Great punish here by SOS. Seeing that the army's out, he can get a few free pot shots on the probes. What is that, six workers? Totally worth it.
Yeah, very good continued harassment here.
But does he have enough? I think that SOS is about to go back onto two bases, unless Stats is going to try to end it right away. But I think that's not very Stats-esque.
Yeah, I don't think can Stats actually get up the ramp? This army is better in open fights. Like, if you come down the ramp, it'll slaughter you, but if you go up...
He could send the Warp Prism in the main and warp in there.
Yeah, he could do that same type of move we saw SOS get some okay damage with.
I think he actually can get up there.
What's
really stopping
him? He's got a better army.
Yep, he's going to go for it.
Like, for sure, but look at the nice concave. Yeah, you should be able to just.
Well, I think he could just juggle the Archons like this.
Yeah, for days
here. He can move the army he needs to move just right up here. And there's nothing that SOS can do about it. Guys, SOS, the two-time world champion, is not moving on to the round of eight.
The IM world champion, two-time GSL runner-up. One of the most accomplished, winningest players of all time.
Yeah, but getting smashed by Stats, showing at least in this series, the conservative, safe player is going to outdo the guy who's trying to be a sneaky snake.
He's trying to be Mr. Fancy Pants. It doesn't work out this time.
Not today, I'm afraid. And that means we're going to have Bjorn versus Stats for our final match here today.
Oh, the rematch.
Yeah.
Bjorn kind of, well, he monster punched Stats in the first
right
game.
Right to the moon, as they say.
So, like, can Stats bring this into a regular fight now?
Okay, you know, Stats probably feeling quite a bit of relief after taking out SOS, who, you know, is really, you never know what SOS is going to do. That's why he's so dangerous.
Yeah, yeah.
But he's overcome it. Now, has Stats learned enough? Has the series that Stats lost against Bjorn, has it had time to marinate in his mind? And does he have a solution?
Yeah, yeah, I think so. Like, Bjorn really dictated game one, and game two definitely played very well, had some triple-pronged harassment, right? But Stats knows how to deal with all these things. I think he was definitely caught off guard. He underestimated Bjorn. I think a lot of people probably did coming in, but Stats won't make that mistake this time. I think it'll be a good match.
Nobody go to sleep yet. We got Stats versus Bjorn coming up next year for our last match of this round, the round of 16.
As fast as you can, as high as you know, my friend, you're not alone. It's bright to come home, too bright to be free, my friend.
Everything you do falls apart. Everything you say is from the heart. Nothing that you think stays the same. Nothing isn't carved in stone but your name. Probably in time, you'll find what you need to. Sing it all together and preaching to the choir. Tears, cause a baby's life has been revoked. The bone is broke up, so choke up and foe. Guess on the clothes I miss, a wizard can reform. Now God like hocus pocus, so don't sit back, kick back and watch the world get pushed. Rag news and in your neighborhood is under attack. Put away the crack before the crack put you away. You need to be there when your baby's old enough to relay. Hey, hey, so don't delay. Supplies are running out. Allow if you're still alive. 6 to 8 years to arrive. And if you follow them, may be out tomorrow. But if the offer's young, you might as well be walking on the sun. You might as well be walking on the sun. You might as well be walking on the sun. You might as well be walking on the sun. You might as well be walking on the sun.
아프리카 TV에는 당신이 아는 것보다 다양한 인종이 살고 있죠. 말 많은 인종, 발 빠른 인종, 잘 먹는 인종, 영리한 인종, 친절한 인종까지. 모든 게 컨텐츠가 되고 누구나 주인공이 되는 세상. 알고 보면 멋진 세상.
Are you free? Africa TV.
And then the round of 16 is done. Stats and Beyond are duking it out. This is a rematch from our start of the day.
Yeah.
Beyond surprisingly 2-0'd Stats. Now, of course, Beyond is a great player. He's been the world champion before. Stats lately has been a little bit hotter, so a lot of people are expecting, especially with Beyond's style of, he likes to push, he likes to attack in, he likes to micro, especially small sets of units.
Yeah.
But Stats likes to defend, and nobody really defends as well as he does. So we assume that we'd probably see a good game, but one where Stats would win. Beyond has brought a totally, like, a remastered style from before. Not only is he aggressive, like always, but he's coming out and he's shutting down scouts. He's dictating the pace of the game. He's oftentimes not overextending. And frankly, he bulldozed Stats before Stats ever got to be where he wanted to be.
Yeah, now, it was really impressive. I actually thought it was going to be one side in Stats' favor, but Beyond really smacked him down. Now, with the new Beyond ready to go, I think Stats has had enough time now. He's very warmed up at the moment. I think we're going to see a better series, but I honestly don't know who's going to take it because Beyond played so well before, but I'm so used to Stats killing Beyond.
Stats has had time to look at those games, think about them, and come up with a counterplay. Yun as well, though. Let's see.
Oh! I guess that's the type of day we're having here.
I got this idea from a guy whose name starts with Gumi and ends with Ho.
What is this? The probe is actually looking for something like this, isn't it?
Yeah,
the way it walked out there? It's actually looking for this. But
he went too soon.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
How do you go?
Now he's really not going to think it's coming. The only thing that's worse than not scouting a proxy is trying to scout for a proxy and not finding it and still getting proxied. So,
yeah. You spent a lot more scouting time to do this. And
yeah.
The thing is, his scout was so early. This is just off the pylon, but it's not timed out to catch that SCV, I guess. It's not well-timed at all. But when he gets here, he's going to know that there is a proxy, right? And here's this, just a little difference I want to bring up from how Gumiho was doing it against SOS. You see the depot at the wall, right? That really screams that they're going to make their factory in their main base. They don't have to, but it gives you an idea that probably you're going to have to deal with a Reaper right away, but then it might just go into a more normal game.
Okay. Again, Beyond, some of the best Reaper control, probably actually the best Reaper control we've ever seen. Yeah. He is the Reaper guy. He's going to come in here. Let's see how much damage he can actually do. Now, Stats likes to play the reacting game, but nobody really is thrilled when they're getting proxied, you know, because you can take so much damage early on.
Yeah.
There's a difference between people that like to push you and attack you and drop you and people that are avoiding a normal game.
Yeah. Here comes that Reaper. Comes from an angle he did not expect because he scouted over there, but just at the wrong time. All right, one probe. Can we have three probe?
He's not even moving
that one.
And this is going to be so frustrating for Stats already.
Three? You
know, he probably had such big plans for this game, but already Beyond is seizing the moment. Oh! Bop.
Man. The fact that already three are dead and it looked like a fourth almost went down. That is so painful. Like, remember Gumiho didn't even get one when there was a Zealot out. Stats' micro was not perfect, though, to be fair. Beyond's was, Stats wasn't. Now, he has his own Stargate, can go Phoenixes. I guess he learned something here from SOS. Right? Because SOS on Eastwatch, this is kind of what he did, right? He went into Phoenixes right away, and he ended up losing, but the early game was so his.
Very true. Very true.
Now, this is different because there's not a proxy factory. The factory is at home. But the Phoenixes are still all right.
I think the Phoenixes can be a very good point if he can get enough of them. Looks like the Reapers are going to try to come in now. Looks like he might. Yeah, he does manage to get that one Reaper.
Yeah, you may as well lift it.
Well, you need to get something underneath that, do some damage. And so that's going to be the end of Reapers for this game, at least. But I think that the Phoenix play is good. Now, he obviously saw the Phoenix there. He knows that this is going to be a factor. That might force Beyond to play a little bit more defensively here, since you can't filter units out one by one anymore. It's impossible to do against Phoenixes. That's exactly what they would want.
Yeah. He's just making some Cyclones right now. But you know what? The Phoenixes, at least, are going to give scouting intel. Before, we saw that this was a big problem for Stats. He wasn't able to see what Beyond was doing. Yeah, you might be able to push them back for a second, but they'll just fly back in when the lock on of the Cyclone is done.
Ook.
Oh,
lucky for him that finished in time.
Yeah.
Okay, so he gets the transfer there. And Cyclones are still going to be coming out now 2x2 here with that reactor over there. And the Barracks finally coming back home. Production is completely normalized here for Beyond. And look at this great play. Knowing that the Phoenixes hadn't poked in over there, they had to be coming around from some angle. And even though he's not going to kill any, you know, damaging these is quite important.
Yeah.
Because a lot of times, just getting the Phoenix count low or softened up means they can't utilize their abilities, and then you can win in a ground fight.
And five of them coming out. I wonder if he just goes and attacks with these, possibly.
He's making two more.
Oh, my God, that's so many. And he's going for that third command again. We actually saw him do this on Lost and Found before against Stats. So
I guess,
I'm really interested that he's continually doing this strategy.
Well, I guess, you know, when you have this many Cyclones, there's not that much they can do to you, right?
Well, I mean, there's definitely the possibility of an attack because, like, for instance, how many Adepts do you need to kill these Cyclones?
But with Phoenixes, you think it's still totally viable?
The damage output of these right away is going to be pretty high. I guess you can lift and cancel lock-ons. That's actually a very important stasis ward. He hasn't even seen an Oracle, so he might not expect that.
Yeah, but he knows there's a Stargate.
2-3 get trapped here, then Stats is fine.
Okay.
Yeah. Look at that. He can't really do anything until that's over.
So that buys time. And time is the most important thing, especially with a timing attack like this one that we're seeing.
And now five get up. He doesn't even walk to the ramp. He has three sentries. He could have done something there.
I think he was playing a little bit too scared. And look at this. He preempts the Phoenixes.
Ooh,
almost shot out of the sky. The other two are unfrozen.
And now it's seven.
Push is starting. No pylon down there. Just one a little bit north of the Nexus. The Phoenixes are coming forward.
Oh, boy.
But he's kiting very well.
Oh, my God. Widowmines. Oh.
Whoa, okay, it doesn't quite connect in an ideal fashion. And the way he's kiting these, but good play here by Stats. He picks off another one, and he's taking a third base. Now, we know there's a third command center, but it hasn't been landed over here just yet. But seven probes killed.
I'm surprised at what we just saw there. He had 2-3 sentries. Like, why wasn't he standing at the ramp? If you can even pick off one additional Cyclone with a force field, that's really worthwhile. Okay, this is starting to get some decent moves from Stats. He lost quite a few probes, though. Look at that worker count, 48 against 39.
Okay, the Cyclones are coming back now.
And look, one Forge being added for Stats. The Twilight just now being added. Stim is going to finish. 1-1 is going to be way ahead of Stats' upgrades. Like, Stats has to get into splash damage immediately, or he's just going to be overrun.
Very cool to see Stats hold on there. I mean, there's definitely hope for him here.
Yeah.
But, you know, that attack was very scary. You can see actually why it could work against the unit composition that we saw Stats having. You come out there, if you're good enough with maneuvering the Cyclones, they do so much damage to air when they target correctly, that suddenly those are not even a factor.
A volley of seven things that shoot four instantly, it's so much damage right off the bat. And he had already been dealing damage to those Phoenixes as well. Now, Stats has to really put on his big boy defender pants because 1-1, Stim, Medivacs, all this stuff, right? He doesn't have Blink. He doesn't have +1 himself. He doesn't have a particularly large army because his probe count was really stifled early on. He lost most of his tech units. He still has an Oracle, I believe, and one Phoenix, but those aren't going to help that much. Maybe a good Stasis Ward could help him, but...
Or he can try to tag the Medivacs or something.
Gun is in control for sure.
So 1-1 is done. And Bjorn is going to continue to power up. Now, remember the first series, or in case you guys missed it, I mean, Bjorn kept putting pressure on. He kept making really smart decisions. We're seeing this again. You know, Stats is a player. It's like he's building a castle with Legos, right?
Okay.
But Bjorn is that kid with sticky hands who comes over and knocks his Legos down.
Oh my gosh.
And if he could finish, if Stats could finish the Lego castle, if he can get everything set up where he wants to make it,
yeah,
then he's ready to go. But Bjorn is constantly, he's constantly throwing a monkey wrench in the gears.
Mm.
And it looks like it's going to happen again.
Ooh, look at this. Ghosts are already on the way here for Bjorn. He's moving out. Blink just finishes. So that's definitely a nice upgrade to have. How much intel does Stats have as to where he's at and what's going on? Okay, this hallucination might be just time. He needs to bring all of his units over to his third base because this is a massive attack. He is going into double Robo and Colossus tech, or, I mean, it could be Disruptor. We don't know yet, but I think that obviously he needs some splash damage soon.
Scan over here. And it looks like Bjorn is actually going to push it. He's got quite a bit of supply. He has reinforcements.
That's a seriously scary army. Streamlining
in here. He's actually setting up an arc. So there's no way that Stats can come in there. It's not going to be a favorable trade. And he's going for it. He's going to drop. He's going to drop Ghost right in the mix.
Sick EMPs go off.
That was so sick.
Yeah, it was.
I thought it was Widowmines, man, or something else. Yeah. That's what we're used to seeing. The way the EMPs coming out like that, and especially on those sentries, I think that's it for force fields. Hopefully these stalkers coming in on the edge can make a better arc. But I think with the stim, oh, a Colossus over here on the left.
Yeah, the Colossus is so important. He needs to target these Marines down as quickly as he possibly can. The Marauder's really dealing a lot of damage to it. The Colossus helping, but
the units of Bjorn are just coming in. I think he did it again.
Oh,
it's again, it's still a best of three, but it looks like game one is going to Bjorn.
Well, I tell you what, Bjorn is certainly outplaying Stats today.
The Terran players have had it with these Protoss scum.
I guess they have. Well, they've had it for years, but finally someone's standing up and doing something about it.
We're here in Club GSL, and right now these two guys are trying to get into the VIP room.
I think
Stats is saying, let me check your wristband, sir.
Yeah.
Oh, no, you got the orange wristband.
Yeah.
And Stats is going, no, I know Mike, my friend Mike, you know? Sorry, sir.
Go stand in line
stand
for 20 minutes for a vodka hot six.
That's right, yeah. Go back down there and pay $20 for a vodka hot six over by the cigarette booth. And he's like, oh, man.
So,
but there is still a chance for redemption here for Stats.
Stats definitely, the proxy caught him off guard a little bit. He went into Stargate on one base. That's okay. You can do that. Kept flying in, getting hit by the Cyclones. I think this 5-7 Cyclone type of play from Bjorn is a little bit weird for Stats. He probably hasn't played against it too much. I haven't seen it very much
at all. It seems pretty new school.
Not this, like the build that Bjorn's doing today, I haven't seen personally. But he definitely got caught off guard there. The Stasis Ward actually gave him like enough time to get those extra rounds, right? But then he like walks away from the ramp and all the Cyclones come up and he has to pull all his probes and from there, it's all downhill.
Yeah, I mean, the game could have possibly ended there had there not been a Stasis Ward set up.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a chance that a Protoss player could just keep making Phoenixes.
But the fact he doesn't take the ramp when he's got the Stasis Ward there and
he's playing scared is what
it
is.
Yeah, it doesn't make sense. Like, take the ramp, right? Sit there, and if he pokes up at all, you do a force field, you kill one Cyclone, two Cyclones. If he's trying to come up and you're afraid of it, you force field, right? The seven Cyclones now have to walk around. That gives you another warping round.
You know,
like, these are the ways that you stay alive as Protoss.
Also, that closer, the ghost drop, EMP and everything, that was so cool.
And the way he got in there,
Bjorn is really, you know, he's always been great with his units, but the way he's just dictating the pace of the game.
Yeah, he's playing out of his mind today.
And
it's crazy.
This is the third game today that we've seen Bjorn beat Stats, which is telling me that Bjorn really gets this matchup. I mean, Stats holds off everything.
Yeah.
Except for Bjorn's attacks.
It's night and day the way that they looked against each other in Super Tournament. Stats 3-0'd him. It was the worst series in Super Tournament.
Yeah.
It was just one-sided and terrible. And, like, Stats bashed him. And here we are in Bjorn now returning the favor 3-0. And we got to sit here and be like, whoa, there's like, it seems like there's mistakes from Stats, but it's like Byun forcing them. It's really, his play is so good today.
And the plays had variety each time. I mean, the theme is always the same, is that he applies pressure and dictates the game and ultimately wins with a big push. But he's doing different stuff every time. Hmm. The closer is always always changing. It looks like our player break is up.
Wasn't three-pronged harassment that time, for sure. Like, that's what we saw last time on that map. And nope. Just like one big attack, let's go.
And let me tell you something. If you're a defensive player like Stats, where you hold up everything until you have the perfect unit comp and win, losing games like this is scary. It's like your reality's falling apart.
Yeah.
It's like that part in the never-ending story where the whole world's breaking up and stuff, and you're calling for Falcor, but he's not there.
Well, the nothingness is after Stats.
That's right. The nothing might win this time.
Yeah.
Byun, great control. We're going to Acid Plant, a map these guys have had a lot of experience on. Let's see what happens.
Splice. Stats.
Byun. Almost sad there's not a barracks in the middle of the map somewhere.
Yeah, they're playing the matchup wrong, aren't they? You're always supposed to put a barracks in the
middle
of the map. That's the new meta.
It's pretty clear. Now, the winner of this gets to play Classic.
That's right. And that's a tough player to go against. I mean, Classic's no joke.
No.
Whether you're a Protoss or a Terran. And I feel like Classic style actually could be a threat to Byun.
Oh, Classic, like, Stats is defensively the best Protoss player. So I generally think of him as matching up very good against Byun, even though that's not the case here tonight. But Classic's the best PB tier, like, for real.
Oh, yeah.
He's not just defensive either. He defends through attacking you relentlessly oftentimes.
Do you think Stats is going to do some kind of a timing attack? I mean, I'm starting to worry for him here. He's tried to play his own game. Like, leave me alone. I'm trying to set up my stuff.
I think he'll just go Stargate, to be honest.
But do you think there's any kind of special move where he's going to try to come in there and end the game before Byun can get to where he needs to be?
I don't think so.
Okay.
I think that he should just stay calm and play his normal play. Just make sure he gets a scout over there and figures out what Byun's up to, because so far that is where Byun has truly been abusing him. And Stalker right off the bat. So this points more towards like a blink opening. We saw him do this previously today and it didn't end up working out, but. Okay, it is a Stargate actually, never mind. Oh, you know what that is Stalker is actually? Because a lot of times you get the Adept to try to deal with the Reaper. That's really funny. It's like, no, there might be a way. There's not. Ooh, just barely gets out of it.
Yeah, good save.
But the fact that he's making Stalkers is a nod towards the amount of Cyclones that we've seen, because Adepts just don't even, I think they heal Cyclones. But yeah, the Stalkers can actually kind of fight that battle. No Cyclones this time, though. Widowmine on the way. Looks like probably a Widowmine drop coming up.
Okay. The Reaper, again, going to try to come out here. He's looking for the front to see if there's anything else you can see. Wow, look at that scout.
That was a sick
scout.
That
was great. You know, he knows that Byun's been trying so hard to control the pace of the game and see what he's doing. He just sent a probe right in there blindly and got the scout off. And I think Byun even noticed it a little bit late.
Command center upgrade complete.
Hey, Oracle coming up. There's a Viking on the way. Nice defensive Viking.
Nice. Stats takes out that one Reaper. And from here, we're going to have Stats make that Oracle.
Look at that Widowmine. Okay. That definitely could catch you. Let's see it.
Stats takes a third base behind this, hoping that the Oracle can keep pressure on. Byun has to respect this. Now, it seems like he's aware this could be coming. He hit a mine kind of in the middle of nowhere, hoping that, you know, maybe Stats won't have his screen over the Oracle as it comes in. I don't know if there's anything else hidden over here. But with a Viking out, it's going to take a good amount of damage. So he's going to have to run back out of here.
Okay. Just takes a little bit of hold damage there and gets out, but so with still has at least.
With the second Oracle coming up here, he wants to also try to hit behind here. Now, I don't believe I see a mine anywhere here. And so he absolutely could get some kills. You know, one Viking, it's a deterrent for staying, but it's not enough to not tempt someone like Stats to try to come in here and get some free kills.
You know, he's fly out of there. Where is that Viking now? Should be coming up for that flank. Oh, actually turns around. Now, we saw a Raven made, so that definitely can complicate a battle coming up a little bit later. But the build from Stats here is much more kind of what I wanted to see. He's got good scouting already done, even though the harassment didn't do much damage. But it's allowed him to get his third Nexus extremely quickly.
He's Look at this.
Right into Twilight and Forge as
He's
well.
Banking Phoenixes as well.
Huh.
So to the eye of the Terran player, you might assume that he's done with the Stargate tech. You want to keep in mind he does have Oracles. They could fly in if he tries to leave. They could try to tag his medevacs. But continuing to produce Phoenixes, he's made at least
How
two.
Many?
We're waiting to see what the third one's going to come out here.
He has two Phoenixes right now.
Is it one with each Oracle? Is that the?
Maybe that's the case, to just try to make sure you kill any medevacs that come in. I'm not sure. Because, like, one Phoenix can be okay. But if you're going Blink, you don't want to go Blink and Phoenixes. Then you have no power in your army. There's nothing there.
Yeah, you've just got cool abilities, and then all your stuff dies.
You're like, look at me. I can kill medevacs. And that's all
I'm over
all
here,
you
now I'm
do.
Over there. Now you're in the air, and then all their, all their units with guns shoot you down.
Exactly.
Well, he only made two, so you're right about that. I thought he was going to start making more and more, and we're going to see something really weird.
Well,
but
if you do that, you have to go glaives or charge. It's like the Stalkers aren't going to have
This is why
punch.
I was. Yeah, that's why I was. I thought it was kind of weird, right? But the push is coming out now. Actually, I shouldn't really say it's a push. He's going to try to tear down some of these rocks. But Bjorn is at least comfortable asserting himself on the map. Stim's almost done, and that's when Bjorn, I think, can actually opt to attack. And I think pushes may be the better way to go than drops, especially with a small number of Phoenixes, Oracles on the map, and Blink is done, or is going to be done soon.
Yeah, now throwing down some stasis wards in some really key locations.
If he leads with the Raven, that's going to be pretty handy.
I tell you, the Raven is definitely something that can mess up whatever battle occurs here. Anti-armor missile in a situation like this, with this many units, really can be helpful. Okay, let's see what Stats can get done.
Careful.
Poking.
So he wants to be like, oh no, please don't chase me. He wants him to go into the trap.
10 seconds more.
He's like, okay, good scan. He picks up.
Okay, 15.
He's going to try to loop around here. This is also booby trapped.
Indeed, it's very important.
Ooh, shaves off a mine. Nicely done. Bjorn trying to hold his ground.
Yeah, good force heals.
Oh, Stats got really good defense this time.
Yeah, and look at that. With the tag, he's able to pick off another Widow Mine. Ooh, I like the landed Viking here.
What are you doing, my Viking? It's not every day you get to see a landed Viking get picked up, guys, okay?
Yeah.
Just take a moment and appreciate that. The warp-ins continue to grow here for Stats. Bjorn tried to find an opening. You know, on this map specifically, if you can control your side of the ramp, it's pretty hard for them to push through it.
Yeah, you get a nice little clutch of sentries. You have a stasis ward up there so they can't just run through. Very excellent defense here from Stats.
Bjorn is regrouping once more. We have another scan coming in here. All right.
Oh, my God. He actually disables all the sentries here so he can push.
Yeah, and without those sentries, you can't control the ramp.
Oh, man. He even targets down the stasis ward. Very well done. But eventually, Interference Matrix runs out and he gets his force shields out.
He snipes the mines.
Dude, that was super, super cool that he Interference Matrix all the sentries. Like, I've never seen that before, but that was awesome. Like, those were the things defending Sats.
Yeah, I wasn't quite expecting that. Cool play. Stalkers try to come up. Now he's just trying to see if he can't get any more damage. Even if he doesn't kill that many units, he's making the medevacs use their energy to heal when there might be a more important moment when Bjorn has to commit and maybe Stats can come out there. I mean, all these little things begin to add up. Another great tag on the army. Guys, Stats is bringing the defense we were waiting to see for.
Yeah. And he's hiding a prism right now that has four High Templars in it while Storm finishes up. That's like a nail in the coffin type move. Your opponent doesn't realize that he's about to be stormed four times. You can go attack. He thinks, okay, I can engage that. Prism comes in and the game ends.
I don't think Bjorn's going to get in here. You can see he's really trying to force this. Oh, he's going to set this off. No, he's not. He has a Raven. I'm sorry, everybody. My bad. Another force field goes down.
Actually, that's really funny because I wasn't thinking about the Raven in the context of detection this game. I was thinking more of its spell cast. And when the other one got shot down, I'm like, I don't remember a scan, but I guess there must have been.
Okay.
All right, pretty good.
Oh, my God. No, never mind. He knows what he's doing.
And that storm was okay, but now that he knows that the storms are out, he can be more careful about them.
Well, I think Bjorn has to go home. Great storms. Oh,
oh
my God.
What? Why did he stay there? That was so obvious.
All right. Stats is just going to go across the map.
Yeah, this that army just... really got hurt.
Oh, my God.
Wow.
Good dodge.
Yeah, miss anti-armor there. So Stats can try to just walk around. His army is just so much better right now. Still has those High Templars in the prism.
Okay, he's going to try to come up. Not a bad defensive position, but the numbers are just so high. Ooh, nice snipe. Sorry, we were being quiet, waiting to see if that would happen.
All right, here he comes. Push in once again here.
Okay, I think
a little bit of harass on the left.
He needs to pick up the Warp Prism. I think fly in there with some good storms, and everything is going to melt. Does Bjorn have the control? Is control ever going to be enough here?
Oh,
wow.
This Ice Storm's definitely looking good. There's so many Stalkers in here. You can clean up those Liberators really quickly as well. It takes a while to get over to them, but a blink forward on top of these Marauders.
Yeah, it's just Marauders here. Now, the Immortals aren't even in the fight. They don't even need to be. GG. We're going to the last game. So cool.
Yeah, much better play from Stats this game. You know what? Bjorn needs to proxy again.
I'm not even joking here.
Like,
no,
the fact
I like
that
it.
Stats was able to just make a couple Oracles and a third Nexus, that allowed him to get into a decent position. You don't need to do damage with the Oracles. Just doing some scouting, keeping your opponent back a little bit, allows you that fast third Nexus. He was able to get his macro flowing. And then, you know, when he hadn't taken a bunch of damage early on or set himself behind with a not perfectly executed early build order.
Look at Bjorn.
Yeah.
He was on a roll against Stats. And, you know, Stats, he won the way that Stats wins. Uh-oh. You know, better off winning in the winner's match than going back down to someone who can adapt.
Yeah.
This has got to be scary for Bjorn. And, you know, you've got to think in his mind, what build is he going to pick? Does he go for the proxy?
Gosh.
Is that too obvious, though?
Man, what map is it?
I don't know.
It's Lost,
Lost
and found.
Okay, there it is.
I was setting you up easy there,
Nobody Tasis. Knows Artosis. It's not on our screen in front of
known.
Us.
It actually is right in front of you.
Stats, though.
I mean,
you know, does he want to mix it up? He's Stats is probably the most conservative player in the GSL.
Generally, yeah.
You know,
you're
he's,
right.
he doesn't need to be crazy. He just has to do what he practiced, and it works. Okay, guys, this is it. The last game in the round of 16. One player moves on, the other one is out.
Okay, that.
Well, that's the answer to that question.
It's so true. This is like, it seems to be that this might be a weakness here for our Protoss players. Wow. I'm really happy that Bjorn has chosen to do this proxy. Like, if the proxy kept not working, then that would be one thing to be doing,
you know,
this. But
Stats is a guy that doesn't set the waypoints. He spams it out. There's no way we're going to know until the last second if he's going to spot the barracks. Now, of course, there's so many places to hide something. This is a new map, too.
Yeah.
We don't truly know the meta of hidden buildings yet on this map.
That's a thing, too.
He's even going by that GSL logo on the map. He's like, oh, that's right, I'm in the GSL.
See
this
that?
Match is important.
He doesn't know the meta, as you said.
It's not going to go down there.
Oh, boy.
Man.
Oh, boy.
Now, Stats knows there are still possible places that could have been hidden, right? But you got to go to their base, too.
Yeah,
I mean, you can scout their base and then see that the barracks isn't there and know that something's up.
Yep. And you just got to make sure that you're there before you start your Nexus so that you can not do your Nexus.
Heart palpitation here for Stats. Oh, God. Not this again.
So there goes the Cybernex Core immediately. It's going to send two probes out. Okay. I was going to say. Like, that's
a
little bit.
He checks and says natural again there. Did you notice that?
Yeah.
He's like, was it made in there? You remember that?
Oh, that's
from
true.
From the earlier games.
Oh, that's so funny. He did make that mistake before.
But that was another probe that scouted that wasn't mining again, doing stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
So, I mean, these are all these little things that are happening.
Okay, well, the factory is being made at home. And his probe will see that. Definitely important intel. Shows you the level of of build you're against. The factory's proxy, it's almost an all-in. Really, we saw how hard Gumiho had it recovering when he had his out on the map. Okay, let's see if he can not lose two to four probes. He has good building placement against this, actually. Nice wall against the Reaper. Okay, much better this time. Look, Stats is really, he's doing such a better job of defending this time, for sure.
Yeah, I mean, so far, so good. You know, when you do this proxy, guys, there are these obvious disadvantages if you don't do an incredible amount of damage. I mean, that barracks is not making. He's got to fly that all the way home. Stats is, he's been a good Boy Scout this game, you know? He's getting all his merit badges. He's staying back home. He's teching up. And Bjorn does take that risk. Now, Bjorn's an adaptable player, so, I mean, it's not like it's something Bjorn can't recover from. But, hey, so far, so good here for Stats.
Yeah, definitely. You're right about that. The starport hidden in the natural here because, of course, Stats is a probe is stuck in the main base.
You know, it's a smart way to play against some of these defensive players is you keep hiding information because it makes it harder for them to figure out the right fork in their build to go down to respond to you correctly.
Okay, so Robo going to be finishing up. You know, just the fact that he's forced this robot, does he make the Immortal right away or will he try to get out an Observer? Let's see. Yeah, the Immortal going to come out. So he's choosing safety here. I can't really blame him, to be honest.
No, I think it's he's doing what he's what works, you know, for him. What has historically brought him success. So here's the Raven coming up.
Oh, you know what's cool about that? You can catch every Observer forever.
Yeah, and remember, this is it's not the exact same way, but it's the same idea as how he won his first game against Stats. Or you and I were both looking at each other and saying, "Whoa, wait a minute! You know, this is a different kind of Beyond. It almost looks a little bit like TY."
Yeah.
He comes out and he shuts down the Observers. And it seems like a big theme that we're seeing, especially in this game, is denial of information.
Yeah.
Keep Stats guessing.
That's a huge part of StarCraft. You know, there's so much stuff is being hidden from each other.
Well, that's the hardest part about trying to teach someone else StarCraft that doesn't, you know what to do is first you got to teach them what to do in their base. But while they're doing everything in their base, they have to go figure out what's going on in the other person's base. And have those two, kind of the algorithms they're both trying to follow. Okay, so how do I respond to this? And that's why this game is so hard.
By the way,
yes.
Look at this, right? He's going double forge on two bases when he has a robo. You can do it. It's super uncommon to see this, though, right? Because normally if you're going double forge early, you want that to be with masses of gateway units to really utilize those upgrades as best you can. But because you don't have a quick third Nexus, you just won't have as many gateway units as you would normally if you took a quick third Nexus. So, right, that's why you might see, like, the Oracle as the opener for most Double Forge builds, because it allows you a quick third base, which means more units, which means your upgrades mean more. But to spend this much money on the upgrades, I'm wondering where Stats is going. It's a super safe play. But, yeah, it's just it's a little bit odd.
Well, here he goes. He's going to get that Observer.
Yeah.
No! I think what Stats is really doing is being even more conservative than what we're used to seeing, especially with that double forge. Okay. Just stay back. Just make the game last for a long time.
Well,
now, go ahead, please.
It's just the way I'm looking at this right now, right, is Bjorn has not made a third command center. He has a Raven. He's making a good amount of bio. He's getting reasonable upgrades. Sure, Stats is going to have 1-1 and maybe blink, and he's got an Immortal. Maybe he'll make some more. But I can see Bjorn hitting a timing push here and using some interference matrixes. Shut down the Immortals for, like, a battle.
Hey, he did. You know, he's already shown that he really gets how interference matrix works. Sorry, guys. These casts go on for very long. My mouth gets tired sometimes. He might be able to come in there and just shut him down. So Stim, close to finishing up, and that's how we know that Terran is going to move out, because with Stim, you can actually start to initiate.
This is a scary, scary push that's coming.
Yes, it is.
He doesn't have blink done. He's going to have two Immortals, maybe a few sentries. I think that, look at that. The Seed Shank is hidden. He's pulling a bunny. Oh man, that's a lot of energy. You can do a lot of things with this Raven right now. This is scary for Stats.
Okay. Stats has a good angle. He has okay, but this tank is going to cause a problem. Whoa. Yeah. Bion just goes for it.
There's that interference matrix just destroying.
Look at this. The rest of the army, he didn't expect him to actually just dive like that. Especially when you see a tank siege up, you think they're going to hold their ground. Look at this. He's just running in here.
Yeah, this army is not going home unless he wins the game with
it. Yeah, man. Just keep going. There's still map there. Oh, and look at this. He's going to go for the forge. What?
Oh, my God. This is such good play from Bion, even dropping those auto turrets.
I don't even know what to say.
And his third base is actually still taking a pounding. I don't think it'll die, but...
But I think he's going to lose the medevacs. He lost a big chunk of his army.
Yeah, he did.
Losing the upgrades, though, what a weird game.
Yeah, killing the probes and the two forges, that was the one thing that really Stats had going for him. That's how you come back from something like this, is your 2-2 finishes, and you're up by two upgrades for a long time. Instead, they're going to be on even upgrades very shortly.
You know what's funny? It's just... You never think, okay, here's how you stop a guy who's going for two forges early on two bases. You run in there and you kill those two forges so they're not going to do anything anymore.
Well, this underlines one of Bion's super strengths, and what he's shown a lot tonight is he's just being decisive. I don't think that was the plan. I think earlier when he was killing Colossus in Series 1, that wasn't the plan, but he's going in and he sees it and he's just like, bam, go,
well,
do it.
You know what's funny? Like I was saying earlier, you see a siege tank sieged up in an army there. You don't think he's going to stim and run it and then just keep going.
Yeah.
And so Stats is trying to reconfigure his army to try to close in on that, and his Immortals were nowhere to be found.
Okay, Bion keeping the pressure on here, has those mines out. Oh, God.
Oh, my God.
Huge move from Bion on this third Nexus. Stats. He's going
to
get it.
He's scrambling to get back, and it looks like the Nexus will go down.
That is a big kill right there. Some mines going off as well. Two medevacs get away.
Wow. Narrow escape there for Bion. And look at this, he's just going to pull back. He says, I'm ahead now.
Yeah.
I'm going to go make more stuff.
If he actually backs up and just gets his units together, because his third Nexus just finished, or his third command center, rather, so he can really get his economy going. Look at that, just transferred the SCVs. His upgrades are totally fine here.
The forges are back. Chronoing them like crazy.
You would be almost half done 3-3 right now, by the way.
Yeah, yeah. Jeez. He's trying to play catch up here.
Yeah.
Stats has got to be careful. Every unit is so precious.
Yeah, going to lose an extra couple of these Stalkers, it looks
just
like.
Bleeding off these extra units is going to be scary. Now, I don't think Bion should commit here. I think that this is not necessary. Stats is being patient.
Yeah, he's trying to be super careful.
If Psystorm
finishes? What if Psystorm finishes?
Then I think Bion might throw this away.
Yeah, it could be.
You know,
that's
I think.
A cute move.
Look, he's going to. Oh my God, Bion might be overextending here.
Cute feedbacks there as well, really utilizing everything he has right now to stay alive. 2-2 is almost done, but not quite there yet. Letting his Zealots take a lot of hits here. Oh, he finally gets Psystorm out and pushes Bion back. And all this right before 2-2, so that would have gone way Stats favored if that hadn't occurred, or if that had occurred a little bit quicker.
Okay, that's another good catch. Will it get away? He can't pick it up with the Warp Prism. It's already full.
Yeah.
But he has Templars. Notice the supplies got closer for a little bit there. That wasn't a great engage there for Bion. But Bion is a very, you know, he thinks on his feet.
Yeah.
He's very reactive.
Super reactive.
Occasionally impulsive.
Yeah.
There's been periods where he's had a lead, but he's got to be careful. You know, one really good engage here from Stats, and that advantage is gone.
Well, the advantage does exist right now. He's making some ghosts finally here.
Look at how Stats is expanding far in the upper left. God, another good pickoff here for Bion. He's just everywhere.
Yeah, Stats sees where his opponent is. That's definitely important.
He doesn't want to push it. Infantry weapons just finished. Oh, okay. He sees it, and he's going for it.
Good size storm.
This is kind of what Stats wants. He wants to just get those storms up. He wants his army all squishy.
Oh!
Snap turnaround.
Wow.
Shoots the Warp Prism down.
Four High Templars and a Prism killed there.
So
super
crazy.
Good.
It happened so fast, I almost didn't realize what was going on at first.
Yeah.
You could see Stats wasn't ready for it. And he just lost that. And I think Stats suddenly completely thrown off. Bion spots the hidden base up here.
Okay.
Let's just follow these Marines until they die. Byun's taking a fourth base of his own. Now, this is the more normal fourth base to take on this map. It's closer to everything else. It's a little bit easier to defend.
Yeah.
Byun scanning everywhere outside of his base, hoping to find more observers, trying to control that Robotech, and he's getting ghosts.
I am not liking this for stats right now. Byun has been playing out of his mind. He's in such good shape. His army is super scary. He's on equal upgrades. The fact that he lost four High Templars, look at this. He's got like one in that prism.
EMP on those Immortals, making him a little bit weaker. Notice that the Immortals are staying out of the Marauders, rather, are staying out of the range of the Immortals.
Oh my god.
Stats is backing up, and Byun is closing in. At the sight of the Warp Prism, he backs up. He's going to try to use that force field against Stats. Stats advances anyways.
Oh, EMPs are hitting these High Templars as they drop out.
Yeah.
Just such quick micro from Byun.
Really good preemptive EMP as
Stats trying to hold on. Both the Immortals die. That is huge.
But it looks like there's barely enough here, and Stats pushes Byun back anyways.
Just barely so, but Byun at home has such a better army. That's everything Stats has. You got to remember this, right? Warpins occur in battle for Protoss, so what you see is what you get with Byun. He's got a whole other army at home.
Okay, another pickup here. Looks like he might try to loop around and hit this base in the center right. He's trying to get Byun to start paying attention to at home, because Byun keeps coming out and Stats is having to try to fend him off.
Now 3-3 is going to be finishing up. Plus 3 armor, that is no laughing matter. Obviously, EMPs are going to be a big part of this game. Looks like he no longer is utilizing his Prism for High Templars, but instead going for some counter
harassment. Oh my god, look at this. He's going to go right into the main. He knows that Stats is going to be too concerned with that expansion way far out, so he's just going to dive right on top. Oh my god.
Oh, serious
damage. And look, he could just do this again. He could just stim and keep going forward. He could get the Nexus if he wants. The Protoss army is not fast. Mobility is on the Terran side. You can see he's coming back. He gets the Nexus. He can now fight on the ramp if he wants to. The Templars are trying to finally catch up, and an EMP on the Templars.
Oh, nothing left there. He warps in around a Zealots. Maybe he can hold on, but
oh my god, now he's going to go back this way.
God.
I can't believe it. The best defense in StarCraft II Stats is crumbling now.
He's been just impotent against Byun.
Yeah, there's just nothing he can do. Look at this. It's just Stats trying to put out fires, but I think he's going to burn down in this game.
Well, I
and Stats'
like
feeble attempt to try to draw some attention to Byun's base is instantly shut down. I mean, Stats' whole home is in shambles.
Yeah, he's really not got anything left at this point. Byun has doubled his supply.
I think this is the nail in the coffin.
Yeah.
There's a wave of Terran units coming forward here. There's not much sophistication with the Protoss' army.
Running under the Liberator as well, warping in each and every unit that he can possibly get. Stats.
Oh my god.
About to be eliminated in the round of 16.
GG, Byun did it. The last guy to get in the round of 8. And he had a hell of a day.
Crazy. I have chills right now. Oh my god. Like, Byun played so well today. In my eyes, he is just redeemed. He's back on that championship level. Okay, there was a long run after that BlizzCon where he wasn't able to do much. You can see how ecstatic he is as well, because earlier this year he wasn't doing well. The first GSL season he didn't do well. Super Tournament he didn't do well. But this season, his TVZ, his TVP, top tier.
And I feel for Stats right now. I think Stats confused. A lot of people were saying, you know, he was the best, him along with Rogue, of course, the best players in GSL.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, not this GSL.
No, not this
round of 16.
네, 돌아온 야인 변현우 선수 만나보겠습니다. 축하드립니다.
Let's say hi to Byun. Congratulations. You had a great
와,
comeback.
2016년 보여줬었던 그 거친 야생의 매력.
Seems like the Byun from the past
먼저
is back.
승리 소감 어떠신가요?
어, 일단 오늘
You're looking animal-like in these games. How do you feel?
2패 탈락할 줄 알았어요. 저는
I came today with no expectations.
저번 주 일본에 갔다가 개인 사정으로 어제 도착해 가지고
I went to Japan last week.
했는데,
네.
연습할
Out of personal reasons.
네.
그래서
so I didn't feel like I had that much time to practice.
오늘 떨어질 것 같다 생각했는데 경기장 오니까
That made me feel a little bit worried.
그래서
I was thinking, man, am I going to get eliminated? Didn't have time to prep. But as soon as I got into the games,
네.
It went really well.
이렇게 반응이 폭발적인 건 2016년 그 전성기 때 그 불곰 멋진 야생의 매력을 뿜뿜 뿜어냈었던 그 불곰을 다시
From what I saw your Marauder play, it looked like that old school Byun we know. What is your take on your own Marauder play?
위주로 플레이하다 보니까
저한테 조금
So the patch is mostly about
말했듯이 김대엽 선수한테 안 좋고 저한테 좋은 패치라서 이렇게 units. 좋은 경기를 할 수 있었던 것 같아요.
So I don't know if the patch was really great for Protoss. I think it's helped me
네.
out a lot.
아, 그 불곰의 패치가
I think the match before the patch I might have actually lost.
준것 같다 이야기를 하셨는데 사실 오늘의 승리는 인간 상성 김대엽을 꺾었다는 아주 중요한 의미가 있거든요. 이 부분도 아주 좋으실 것 같아요.
I think it's very meaningful since he managed to take out a player
네.
like Stats.
박진영 해설이
you hardly ever win against him in the past.
네, 네 오프라인에서 제가 김대엽 선수한테 밀릴 뿐이지 총 상대 성적을 제가 많이 앞섰거든요.
Actually, JYP had mentioned that as well. That's our Korean caster.
최근의 성적이 정말 중요한 거 아닌가요?
Probably my record is not really great against him.
최근에 저한테 인간 상성 아닌 사람이 없어요. 제가
But my recent record.
근데 저는 네. 김대엽 선수한테 항상 자신감이 있었기 때문에
네.
저는 제가
Says that I was very much fell behind against stats, but
네.
honestly,
2017년
I feel like my record lately has been behind against everybody if you actually look at all the numbers.
오역이었는데.
So,
네, 이 변현 선수의 내재되어 있는 그 자신감이 좋은 경기력의 또 원동력인 것 같기도 합니다.
I guess you still didn't lose your confidence totally, though.
사실 오늘 정말 깜짝 놀랐던 게 아니 변현우 선수가
It was truly a surprise to see.
운영을 정말 놀랐습니다. 이건 어떻게 준비하시게 된 거예요?
네, 제가 연습을 평소에
And very
많이
impressive
하는데
to see your cyclone control as well.
중에는 연습을 못 하니까 너무 스트레스 받는 거예요. 네. 그래서 할 수
So I've been tinkering a lot with cyclone play in general.
방식으로 VOD랑
I wasn't able to practice it as much as I said I was in Japan.
근데 네. 하다 보니까 이게
well, maybe I should be changing my preparation.
And maybe I should just be
I've been thinking maybe I should not
거예요,
try to grind as much and play as much. Maybe I should be studying more VODs. I feel really good that I've kind of had some different prep here. It's been helpful for me.
부랴부랴 했는데 이게 네. 연습 성적도 잘 나오고 그래서 오 이거 좀 되겠다 생각했어요. 근데
네.
이게 단점이
A lot of times when I get in Korea, I just
전신사진 하러 나갈 때
Excuse me, he landed just yesterday, so he's only had one day to actually play. As far as practice goes.
아, 심장 쿵쾅.
Anyways, I think since my mentality wasn't that strong.
자 오늘 정말 이 날카로운
Whenever I do proxy reapers, my heart's always beating a lot.
정말 멋진 모습 보여주신 것 같습니다. 나의 좀 부진했던 이런 그 성적들의 아쉬움을 모두 청산하는 그런 좀 전환점이 될 것 같으세요?
일단 다음 8강이 프로토스잖아요.
네,
김도호 선수인데 진짜 힘든 상대를 만나긴 했는데 오늘처럼 이렇게
So the next opponent is Protoss.
이렇게
You're going up against Classic.
그러니까 정성기 때도 항상 그랬거든요. 정석적으로 하지 않고 전직적인 빌드를 섞어 가면서 정석적으로
When I look back at my 2016
네,
self.
준비하면은
I'm not only focused on one style of player. I think I had better mix-ups
네.
than with builds.
네, 김도우 선수와의
so
경기도
Maybe that's what I got to be doing more often against
자,
Protoss.
오늘 환호해 주신 분들이 정말 많습니다.
마지막으로 so maybe I'll have a mixed style against Classic.
아, 네, 제가
Any words to your fans?
진출 승리인지 모르겠어요. 제가 이렇게 환호 승리하고
I can't remember the last time I
기분 때문에 아직까지
got to get this far into GSL. It's been a while.
또 16강이 아니라 8강이든 4강이든
I think a lot of the people cheering for me in the audience that helped me a lot. That was a big motivation for me. So thank you so much.
우승하고 블리즈컨 갔잖아요. 그래서 이번 시즌 2 맞죠?
네.
네, 시즌 2에서 우승하고
I won season 2 in 2016 and I got to go to BlizzCon. So since we're at season 2 of this year, I'm hoping to do that again.
네.
이번에는 진짜 꼭 가고 싶어요.
꼭 우승하셔야겠네요.
네.
And since I couldn't make it to BlizzCon last time,
다시 한번 8강 진출
That filled me with a lot of regrets,
감사합니다.
So I'm really motivated this time around. Please keep supporting me. Thank
네,
yous all around.
마지막 8강 진출자 변현우 선수.
Well, it was fun to get an interview out of Byun. We haven't gotten as many lately just because he's had a tough time since his world championship run. But dude, he is a contender now. It's like really blown my mind. I love it. He's back. He's strong as can be.
How about that, man? The Terrans are the ones that survive, and the Protosses were SOS at stats.
Yeah, that's
SOS
super
SOS is knocked
surprising.
Out first.
Yeah. The fact that neither of them made it out, it's like, what? But
so
now
weird.
Our round of eight has concluded, or it's been made all the way, I guess, is what it is. The round of 16 is the one that's concluded, and we have three of the four horsemen with Innovation falling off. And then, of course, Gumiho, that other Terran.
So funny. We didn't think there were going to be any more Terrans.
Dude, look at
Moving
that.
On.
Look at the bottom side of the bracket. Anything can occur down there.
Suddenly, there are too many Terrans.
Four Terrans. and only a single Zerg in
here. Here's the thing, though. Rogue's probably going to win the whole tournament.
Yeah, I think
the
you're
only
probably
Zerg
right.
Player.
I actually think you're right.
Yeah.
Maru is actually the hardest thing for him to beat
here.
Kids
are going to have to, you know, they're going to be trying to complain on Reddit, then they're going to have to get backspace. Ah, that doesn't make sense because try to write into the. Nah, yeah, I guess the game's pretty good.
You're very
it's
right,
pretty
though.
Pretty balanced.
I think Rogue is definitely favored to win
yeah.
this.
Yeah. So, that's we finally begin day one on Wednesday. Maru versus Rogue, Classic versus Bian. We're done with this group stage crap.
Yeah.
It's time for long, dramatic matches. These guys are going to have a lot of time to only prep against that opponent.
That's right. On Wednesday, we're going to have this match, guys. And Maru Rogue, everybody better tune in for this. Of course, the way Bian was playing tonight, we get to see him go up against the ultimate test as far as Terran versus Protoss goes.
Wow.
Dude, this whole bracket, this whole round of eight, I keep looking at it and thinking about it. Everything can go any way.
I know.
Like, Maru can beat Rogue.
Bian could beat Classic. I mean, he already did it with stats.
It's possible. The way he played today was
I don't know what's going on.
Wow.
Wow.
Exciting times to be alive.
Mm. Life is good.
Yes.
This season has kicked ass. I think you're totally right with what you said. I mean, it could go any way.
Yeah.
For as far as who advances.
Anything can happen from here. It's been a wonderful round of 16. The round of 8 is going to be so sick. We have WCS Austin going on this weekend. Like,
just a good weekend for StarCraft.
Just happy times. Happy times. I don't know.
I don't know.
I would just want to go home and play more StarCraft pieces.
I know. Well, that is all the time we have. Guys, thank you so much for joining us. We love you. Have a good morning, afternoon, or night, wherever you are. Keep to ourselves. I'm as old as time, as way it used to be. I want something more, more of you for me. GSL Season 2, Overgrowth.